features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good morning, everybody, and look who we've got this morning. We've got the Nkahumas, and this is Safari Live. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to a unbelievable sunrise safari. Can you believe it? Right off the get-go, we've managed to find the Nkahumas. Now, my name is Tayla, and on camera with me, we've got Xander, or Eggsy, as some of you may know him. Let's go back to the lions. We're going to have to follow them for a little bit. It's extremely warm this morning. It's 75 degrees Fahrenheit. How beautiful is that? No jerseys necessary, and we're going to carry on looking at these wonderful Nkahumas. Let's reposition. They've actually just come from Jumapan. I'm sure some of you may have been watching them already, so thanks for the heads up. And now they've moved away from that little watering hole. There were some impala up ahead earlier, but they snorted an alarm call and bolted off. And you can see this beautiful big male. Have a look at him. We're going to get a nice close-up of him now. He's quite close to the vehicle. But look how relaxed he is. Look at him marking the territory. Hello, boy. Look at that. Look at his beautiful face. Look at all those scars as well. Ooh, what's happened to your face, mister? Mr. Birmingham. You've got a little bit of a gash on his nose. Maybe he got a paw to the face by one of the females. And I don't know if you can also see it. I just want to show you how lucky we are today. Look at the sunrise peeking through just over as the Nkahumas walk on over in the distance. How amazing is that to have a beautiful sunrise coming up through all those trees and then to have all of the Nkahumas. Now, I'm hoping that they don't go into very, very thick vegetation. It's going to get quite dense up here, which is going to make it quite difficult for us to follow them. But I'm hoping we get to spend most of the morning with us. We were all a little bit concerned this morning that we were not going to see the lion for a few days. But obviously, whatever they killed in Biffle's Hook apparently wasn't too big, because the females don't look too fat, and this male looks like he's hardly eaten anything. Right, let's try and get ahead of them. I think that's the plan, because they are on the move, and just try and find a nice spot where we can sit and actually wait for them to come to us. Let's just see. I'm just going to have a look. No, no, ladies, don't go in there. Please don't go in there. Okay, we're going to poke our noses through. No. Okay, they're going straight again. Okay, that's good. I was worried, very worried, that they're going to go down into this drainage, and then it's almost impenetrable. We're going to find a little gap here. Gappy McGapster. Where are you? Okay, we're going to have to go a little bit further than I thought. It's quite dense here. Yeah, I think we... next one. Next one, and then we're in. And we'll look back and hopefully have the entire pride coming towards us. Oh, it's an old two-track, obviously from a previous sighting. Very easy. Oh, and he's gone completely flat, Birmingham male. Right, I'm just going to squeeze past this little grey shrub over here. You right, Eggsy? Look at that. How has he gone from walking to... I'm so exhausted, I'm just going to have a little nap quickly. Come on. Is this Amber Eyes? It looks like Amber Eyes. Come on, wake him up. Give him a bit of a hiding. What are you doing? Remember, take all the screenshots you like, everybody. And we are live at the moment. So you are welcome to send in some questions too. You can either hashtag on Twitter, Safari Live, or you can send us an email at questions@wildearth.tv. So everybody, this is Amber Eyes, and I'm so happy that I'm getting to know her and be able to identify her a lot quicker. And she really has got the most beautiful eyes, doesn't she? Off she goes. She's right next to the vehicle. I think she likes Eggsy's aftershave. That's what I'm going to go with. And I'll wear the rest of them. Oh, the rest of them are actually coming just up over here. See this little gap? They're on their way through. Good morning, ladies. I can't believe we managed to get them. I was really so worried we weren't going to see them for a few days. But thank you so much, lions. Here they all come. One after the other. All funneling right past my vehicle. That's what I love about lions, is if you give them a bit of room and they are going in a particular direction, they're very comfortable with walking right past you. Hello, all you little fluffy fluffs. That's beautiful. So hello. Yes. Oh, no, okay. I wanted to rub your head, but obviously not. So it's quite interesting. I don't know where they're going, but please don't go into some thick vegetation. Hopefully they're going to find a nice little spot just to maybe rest. Maybe they are pushing into this drainage line. Drainage lines are good. I think there'll be a lot of buffalo, a lot of kudu, nyala, all sorts of animals in this area. Oh my goodness, we are off to an unbelievable start this morning. While I try and reposition and get a great view for you, I know that Jamie and David would love to say hello this morning. So let's head on over to them. And I believe they've got my favorite animal.
Good morning and welcome on another beautiful sunrise safari here in the middle of Juma Private Game Reserve. And what a lovely start. I think Taylor's absolutely right. We are off to an amazing morning. Taylor with her lions and her slow puncture and our lovely herd of elephants that we found ourselves surrounded by. Good morning. My name is Jamie and I have Dave on camera with me. And together along with Taylor and Eggsy, we're going to be searching for all kinds of magical creatures and things to show you out here in the African bush. Right, we started off our morning with these elephants. They've now all shifted past us except for this young male. He is munching away quite happily on the sickle bush. And what struck me this morning is just how much destruction there is in just this little patch of quarantine. It seems as though every tree is sporting some kind of elephant damage, elephant feeding damage, that is. And that's obviously one of the impacts of the drought is that the elephants are far more focused on the trees. There's not much else for them to eat. Now, I was going to shift around and reposition. One of the females gave us a little bit of a head shake when we arrived. They've all relaxed now, though. We're off to a very, very peaceful start. Hello, little boy. Shame, poor Taylor's just been called Jamie on the Game Drive channel. Ah, well done. Well done, Taylor. Right, let's reposition. And get a better view. So once our Ellies decide to move off, I'm probably going to go off in search of Queen Karula. And yesterday was unsuccessful, or at least yesterday's sunset safari was unsuccessful, in that she had disappeared into a drainage line and had not popped out, and we just didn't manage to find her. And what my logic here is that we know her cubs are to the south of our boundary. We know she was hunting. So either we're going to conclusively find tracks of her going south, and that's that, and we can't follow her, or I'm hoping she was successful last night in terms of hunting and she's going to have gone to fetch the cubs and bring them back. That's my hope. Either way, we'll know either way in terms If we find tracks on that main road. If she's crossed, then we'll go to Cheetah Plains. That will be our plan for the morning. I haven't been there in a while. Mommy, are you going to get across with me now? Here we go. Just going to go here. Big female with a calf. The wind's already starting to pick up once again. I hear rumours that there's the chance of rain tomorrow, so I imagine that today is going to be incredibly gusty. We're getting a huge drop in pressure. This morning's nice and warm, 24 degrees, 73 degrees Fahrenheit. A nice warm start to the morning. First time I've worn shorts and not regretted it. And I imagine the elephants looking forward to the slight drop in temperature from yesterday. It's absolutely amazing how they're managing to scratch out a living. Scratch out food, I suppose. Probably a better way of phrasing that. Now, for new viewers, just to let you know, because this is an interactive safari experience, or live safari experience, that does mean that you can send through your questions, and if you have any questions at all, please don't be shy. Let us know who you are, where you are from, because it's nice to know where our viewers are from, in terms of crossing the corners of the globe. We get questions from all kinds of places. And don't be shy about asking a basic one. Some of our viewers have been watching for many, many years, and as a result, I think they've come to grips with pretty much most of the things out here and the information. But that doesn't mean that you should be shy about asking questions. And you can do that on hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. Interesting. Zola does not often bark. That's the dogs from around camp. He generally doesn't bark at anything except big predators. He's quite cross. Might be worth investigating quickly. Keep listening. If he keeps, it's not a fully frantic bark, so it might just be that somebody unexpected has popped into the gate or something. He's stopped now. So Zola is our neighbor's dog, just by the way. And it's a very wonderful thing to have dogs out here, but they have to be particularly well trained, which of course Zola is. Massive legs. We spoke a lot in the tent about the size of the elephant's bones and the structure of their skeleton. Just how incredible they are. You think about how much weight those joints have to bear. Oh, by the way, I asked a question yesterday about elephant skin disease. And we sort of did a little bit of research on it before our internet disappeared completely. Taylor and myself were just chatting about it, trying to see if she'd ever seen an elephant with a skin disease. I hadn't. I think it was Arcadia? Who was it that asked? Andrine. One of our viewers asked about skin diseases for elephants, or specific to elephants, and we haven't been able to come up with much before the internet died, except potentially the elephant pox that they are prone to, but that's not really a skin disease. And it's more elephants in captivity that seem to have that problem. Interesting that there are certain animals that are prone to certain types of skin disease, like black rhino, as opposed to white rhino, and they get those weeping sores on their bodies in the summer months. I've never ever seen an elephant with a rash or a raw patch or anything like that. Obviously not prone to it. course, all of the animals out here have a certain degree of resistance to diseases. I'm quite sad. All of our birds, when we started out this morning, all of our birds were giving us a beautiful demonstration of the dawn chorus, and they've all flown away. We had lots and lots of them. Right, I'm going to leave our Ellies for now and head out in search of the Queen along the southern boundary. For now, Taylor's done a marvellous job of sticking with those lions. Let's jump back on board with her.
Well, everybody, we managed to manoeuvre through some very dense bush. They're moving straight along the drainage line, which made it quite difficult for us to do a bit of manoeuvring around. But Wendy is a machine at going through the bushes. And now these lions seem to have settled down quite nicely. I am also just listening out for Rexon, because I know he's trying to come and view these lions. And we are well off the road. So please excuse me if I do just quickly try and guide him in. Let me just update him, just to let him know that their lions have gone a little bit static. Oh, look at that. Big yawn. Oh, nice teeth. You see, she's a younger girl. And have a look at these two here, two of the older cubs. Look at this. Please, mom, please. Groom, give me attention. And then one little one coming in to say hello. Hello, curious. Oh, here we go. Going to have a big drink now. I think the moms are getting tired of all these little babies harassing them all the time. You can see they're not interested anymore. They're just like, just drink when you need to drink and don't bother me. Oh no. You're going to get growled at, I'm afraid, if you carry on like that. Oh my goodness, that poor mother. Look at them all fighting over to get the best teat. Look, they're pushing it off. Go away. I just want to try and get hold of Rexon very quickly, everybody. You enjoy this, though. Rexon Taylor. Rexon, we are sort of just north, I suppose, of Pangolin Track. Twin Dams Junction. I think we're in the Shkovanin now, but they are static. So if I get your order, I'll call you in to come north. Maria, good morning, and thank you so much for watching the show. I have to agree with you this morning. Maria says that kudos needs to go out to whoever has been watching the Duma Dam Cam, because if it wasn't for them, everybody, we would not be sitting here watching these lions. We would have been checking the boundaries, just making sure to see if they have maybe come in. And you know, we could have been tracking them for a few hours before we eventually found them here. So it was great. Great teamwork by all. And that's what's so important when you are out here in the bush, is that you do rely on other people to try and help you out. Some days you have great days in finding things. You have all the luck. And then other times you don't have as much luck and you have to rely on everyone else. I don't know how long they're going to stay here. You can see one of the other females coming through. She doesn't seem to be wanting to hang around for too long. I bet you're all going to get some amazing screenshots this morning. So remember, you can hashtag Safari Live or send in us an email on questions@wildearth.tv. Hello, beautiful. She's going over there. I just love these little cubs. It was so amazing to see all of those little ones on the road this morning. It looked like everything was in black and white, and you just saw these little spots of tan color popping out. Such a beautiful pride. Those aren't very thirsty. There's a few more little cubs coming through. Let's see if they bother this female. She's very grumpy. Hello, James. Morning, James Richard, who's one of our regular viewers. James says, happy Catterday. James, I can't believe I didn't think of that. It is indeed a Catterday. Hello, little one. They are all around my vehicle. I couldn't think of anything better than to spend the weekend within Kahuma Pride. And for anybody that has just joined in, and maybe you are first-time viewers, we'd love to hear from you. And just so you know, if you hear me saying strange words, like the Nkahumas, this is the resident pride that we see here on Duma Private Game Reserve. So we are in the Sabi Sands at the moment, in the greater Kruger area. So just to give you an idea of how much land is around, there's 8.5 million acres of land that these animals are roaming around on, and we managed to find this wonderful pride of lions. Look at that. Yes, play with each other. I can't, they're right next to my vehicle. This is incredible. And they are just so relaxed. I love how lions are the easiest of the animals to habituate. They really don't mind. The little ones sort of see how their parents walk right past. But now as they're going to get a little bit older, they're going to start to get cheeky and a little bit more inquisitive, especially this older one that we're looking at now. I'm waiting for them to start coming up and sniffing the tires and seeing what. We found out where Aubrey is. Aubrey Taylor. Aubrey, clamoring for these Ngonyam. It's not Makulish Kovenin. They've moved out of that now. I'm trying to. Tasha, good morning, Tasha. Tasha wants to know how many times will a lion cub change color before they reach their sort of adult coloring. Before I answer that, I want to just get a nice spot here because they're all coming around the big Birmingham, and it's always so funny to see the reaction of the Birmingham male when the cubs come over. He's not as keen on the little ones. Look at him, he's being surrounded. Look, 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 look. That's cool. That's amazing. Watch that. Watch. He just did a big snarl, but there's still some more little ones coming over. All they want to do, this is, look at them. All they want to do is just be like, I just want to be like my dad. And he hasn't got any time for them. Right, so to go back to your question, how many times do a lion cub's coats change color before they get their adult coloring? And it's really, my goodness. And that's obviously how that male ended up with a cut above his nose, is because he has got zero tolerance for anybody. I'm going to reposition. Again, this is just too good not to have the best spot. There we go, that's a nice gap there. Come on, girl, give him a hiding again. You show him who's boss. So I'm not sure how many times exactly they change color, but obviously when they're first born, they start off very, very spotty. Just listen quickly, listen to everything. Can you hear those little ones? I'll eventually get you your answer. Trisha, don't worry, I'll get there. But this is just too beautiful to just talk over these lines. So they start off spotted and quite pale in color, and then sort of when they get to about 3 or 4 months old, they tend to go a little bit darker and they start to lose those spots. Though some lions will actually keep their spots for their entire life. I have seen adult female lions with lots of spots still on their legs. It could be a few times. I don't think there's an exact amount, Trisha, as to how many times the lion's coat will change in color. So it's a bit difficult to say. Oh, sorry, Tasha, not Trisha. Sorry. I got so distracted by these incredible lions. You can see that. Oh, look at this, look at this. Wah! Gotcha. Ah, well, while I stay with the Ngahumas, I'm going to try and spend as long as I can with them this morning. Jamie has got a bird for you. I'll see you just now.
We just wanted to show you this incredibly beautiful shot of our Warburg's eagles. Or one of them, anyway. Isn't that stunning? With the marula tree, the striking contrast of the colours. It is absolutely beautiful. Ah, I feel justified, Dave. It is a widow. It is. So I did something that I said I wasn't going to tell anyone about, and I swore Dave to secrecy, but I'll tell you about it now. I went to put my jacket on because it got a little bit chilly, and a spider fell out of it and ran across my thigh and down to the seat below. And I'm good with spiders. I've never had a problem with spiders. But I squealed and stalled the car. Dave nearly fell off it. It's very funny. But in my defense, I took one look at it and went, oh goodness, that doesn't look like a very pleasant spider. And I don't think it is. I think it's one of the button spiders. It just looks terrifying. I managed to catch her because she was trying to crawl over my leg again. So I'm going to release her back into the wild in a moment. She's... here we go. I know that this light isn't great. I managed to fashion a nice way of looking at her without touching her too much. And she's got the marking on her abdomen. So a button spider. There you go. You can just see the red marking underneath. So it's one of the button spiders. Hence, I feel a little bit better about my incredible pathetic reaction. Because of course, they have a neurotoxic venom. It's not very pleasant. It does make you feel very ill for a long time. They're not aggressive spiders. They really, really aren't. They're not out to get people. They relate to the recluse spiders. I think there's the cousins. They have cousins in North America, so you'll be familiar with them. The brown widow, black widow, brown house recluse. Recluse spiders. So you get the idea. Their bite is one of the most dangerous of all of the spiders. They're not particularly pleasant. Which does make me feel a great deal better, Dave, about the fact that I stalled the car and squealed like a little girl. Totally acceptable, thank you, Dave. I feel better about myself. Very cool. And we found a perfect way of containing her for now. I am going to release her back into the wild. I'm not going to kill her, obviously. We don't kill spiders. Please don't kill spiders. They are very, very useful parts of our ecology, and they're very useful in that they kill all kinds of insects, mosquitoes, all sorts of things. So they are very special, except when they crawl across your thigh unexpectedly, at which point I feel as though it is slightly forgivable, but I'm still a little embarrassed. I thought I'd share that with you just to make you laugh. Right, well, I can't go anywhere until I've released this thing. I'm going to try and... how am I going to do this? I haven't thought this through with this wind. Hold on one moment. Okay, we'll pop you on my thigh again. You and I have been getting very familiar. Don't worry, I'm not going to hurt you. Right, the point was I had to unplug my earpiece, which I can't do with both hands occupied in holding the spider. Here we go. The only thing that makes me feel a little bit better about this whole deal is that if it had been my brother, there would have been screams. He probably would have jumped out of the car. So I feel vaguely, vaguely better about myself. Not much, mind you, but little better. Okay, so widows in general they're generally hiding under stones and fallen logs and stumps and so on. That's usually where you find them. You don't usually find them in your jacket. What I'm going to do is I'm going to pop her here under this fallen log so that she's got a place to hide. Whoopsie, sorry. There we go. Sorry, I dropped you. I didn't mean to. No! It's charging me! There we go. Ha-ha! Whatever you do, don't run. Just slowly back away. Here we go. All done. I can put the lid back on my water bottle. Thank you very much. I'm impressed with myself. Sorry, Dave, to ruin your beautiful shot of your Warburg's eagle, which was beautiful. All in a day's work. There we go, so Morning Glory has said, a button spider, yikes, you would have dropped everything and run away. There you go. So I don't feel so bad. It was, the thing is, I was idling along with my foot on the clutch, putting on my jacket, thinking it sort of skittered across my thigh, and I went beep, pulled my foot off the clutch, put Dave is like that on the back. I thought I'd share that story with you, but don't tell anyone, please don't tell Brent. I would be most embarrassed. Tingana the leopard has said that he had a good laugh. He's been watching me the whole time. Where's Tingana? He's been keeping an eye on what I've been doing. You better go back, Dave. We missed Tingana. Ooh, Stembuki? Hello. Might not be Tingana. Luckily, we've got the subtle sound of Rusty's brakes to take us through the morning. Up. There she goes. Look at the speed of those antelope. It's absolutely incredible. I saw a dacre yesterday being hunted by a Karula, and that thing, it came so close. Unbelievable. Whee! That's fast. Jeez, that's fast. A bit panicked as well. Shame. The Steenbok on Philemon's cutline is usually okay. Alright, well, Tingana male leopard, I also had a good laugh. I had a jolly good chuckle at myself, albeit a little bit embarrassed. Hey, AJ Mirabel, thank you very much. AJ Mirabel was impressed by the fact that I managed to catch and hold a spider filled with neurotoxic venom. As I said, they're not aggro spiders. I mean, when I was in Johannesburg, we lived with brown button spiders in our garage for many, many years. And I remember my mom telling me as a small child, just leave them, don't touch them, don't play with them, just leave them alone, and they won't do anything to you. And they never did. They never hurt us in any way. Sometimes you'd open an umbrella or something and a spider would come tumbling out. But they never harmed us at all. But the venom of a button spider, for most people, is not going to be deadly. It's not pleasant. It's painful. It is a painful experience. It's not very comfortable. But for some people, they have wound up in hospital as a result of the neurotoxic venom, and it's probably a bad reaction, but your heart starts to palpitate, you feel nauseous, anxious, and the standard neurotoxic symptoms. It's not paralyzing in the way that something like a mamba venom is, but it's not pleasant. We prefer to avoid that. Plus, there's only two of us, so you'd have no drives. And we definitely don't want that, do we? Although I'm sure I could battle through. Probably not. Impala dashing across the road, being chased by males. I don't think we should get Eggsy to present if I go down. Don't worry, I haven't been bitten by the button spider. Off they go. I bet they know where the leopard is. Right, let's just go and check the southern boundary for Karula. I have a feeling she's around. Just by the way, Taylor's just trying to stay with those lions. They're on the move again. Leading her in circles through very dense. Generally, when you're looking to track a leopard, we know where we left her, we know where she was, but she's obviously not going to be in the same place this morning. So what I'm trying to do is do a huge loop around where she was and see whether she's coming, and then sort of spiral inwards to where we last saw her to get an idea of where she's gone. I think that might work out for us. I'm really, really hoping that Karula's around this morning. I have not seen her cubs. The last time I saw her cubs was with her impala kill high up in the marula tree, and even then I only saw one of them. No, I saw both, but they were quite far away and playing in the shade away from her, and we couldn't follow them. And then of course everything changed, and Tingana arrived with Shadow, and then there was a hyena, and then there was wild dogs, and if I hadn't seen it myself, I might not have believed it. That was the last time I saw Karula's cubs. And just by the way, updates on our leopards. Shadow is mating again with Tingana, which obviously isn't ideal in terms of our holding out hope for the survival of her little cub. It's not looking positive, but I'm going to keep hoping. She's old enough to not take care of herself, but survive. Oh, how wonderful! Taylor has found one of the most incredible and really rare creatures out here. Let's go and have a look.
Have a look at what I've found, everybody. Can you believe this? This is called a lunar moth. And this is actually the first time I have ever seen one in my entire life. We did some very, very thick off-roading now to try and get out of where these lions were, and I think as we were going through some of the shrubs it fell into the vehicle. I see it is slightly injured. I see it's missing sort of one of its end tail feathers. You see that over there, and maybe that's why it's not flying away, because I tried to release it and it didn't want to fly. So what I'll do is I will just put it on one of the trees just before we leave. We've actually got the lions coming out, which is great. So everything is working out into our favor. And I don't know too much about the lunar moths, unfortunately. I've never seen them before, so I'm going to have to do quite a bit of research this afternoon, and maybe I'll be able to tell you a little bit more about them this afternoon. But isn't this beautiful? And I do apologize for my dirty hands. Trying to catch this thing in the vehicle was a nightmare, and it was sort of wedged in the side of Wendy. So I had to stick my hands in, and now they are covered in dust and dirt and all sorts of things. But isn't this just such a beautiful creature? I really, really, really think it's unbelievable. And I'm so lucky to have actually found it. I've only ever heard about the lunar moths, but I've never seen one for myself. So how incredible is that? Look at those beautiful eye spots as well that you can see over here. Isn't that amazing? Oh no, we're talking now. Open your wings. I'm teaching this moth English, as you can see. No, open. Open. Doesn't have a name yet. There we go. You can see those lovely eye spots over there. And that's to fool any predators, as to make them think that they are actually that they are watching them. Meantime, his head is over here. Look at those little, woo! Goodness. No, come back. I thought I was going to accidentally eat it in front of you. This is what it was doing earlier. Come, here we go. I'm training you. No. I'm a friend. I'm trying to help you. Come. It's now on my camera. Come here. No, come. I think what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to release it. No, don't go back there. Okay, everybody. I've lost Mothy, but we'll leave him. He's safe for now. And I will release it at a later stage. I probably need to get out the vehicle, and the Nkuhumas are right here. Right, let's see where you are. just over here. Let's get some nice lighting. Let's see. Hello. Thank you so much, lovely Nkhumas, for taking me through some very thick vegetation this morning. You tested my off-road driving very well, but we managed quite nicely. Hey, Eggsy, what do you think? We didn't die, we survived, which is good. No, I'm only teasing, it was very safe. We didn't do anything adventurous this morning, with just lots and lots of trees in the way. Come on, little ones. What are they seeing? This one female, can you see her there? She's been up and down now for the last few minutes, looking, gazing into the thicket in the distance. So I don't know if she's maybe smelt something. She is downwind of, or she's walking sort of in towards the wind. So maybe she's picked up on a scent. She's, oh, it's a giraffe. That's what she's seen. Eggsy, have a look at the giraffe. Look at that. That's exactly what she's seen. I need to reposition for this. Have a look at this giraffe very quickly. I want to try and either get behind the giraffe or get behind the lions, because it's amazing if you can see their faces. Let me very quickly reposition everybody just to get the best view, because this is super exciting. We're having such an amazing morning. I don't know if you're going to catch that giraffe. Honey, I think you're being a bit ambitious. Let's see how we can go over here. Let's see, can you see one lion with the giraffe? I think you may be able to. We've got the sun not in our favor anymore. The giraffe is just slightly more to the right. You can see there, just to give you an idea, there's the head poking up behind the trees. So the giraffe does know that these lions are here. They're making a lot of noise. The little ones are definitely giving away their presence as well. They are crying and moaning for milk. I don't know if you can hear it now because the wind has just started gusting again. Well, this is so exciting. I could have wondered what. Oh, look, what are you going to do? No ways, everybody. Look at that. You are very brave. What does she think she's going to do? Oh, hang on. This is incredible, everyone. Hold on, Eggsy. We need to just... This is insane. Chase the giraffe. I've never seen lions kill a giraffe before. Go for it. Let's just reposition. We've got a few more females that have popped their heads up. Whee! Isn't this exciting? What a way to start your day. She's in hot pursuit of this giraffe. And that's a big male giraffe, too. Hang on, everybody. I've just got to pick up the pace a little bit here. Now she's stopped. What? And there's some zebra up ahead. My goodness, an action-packed morning today. Okay, so we're having a standoff at the moment. I don't know if you can see either of them. You can see her, and the giraffe is just over there. This is crazy. Now, normally what lions will do, everybody, when they are trying to catch something like a giraffe that's this big, they need to try and chase it over an area that's sort of unlevel and at quite a good speed in order to try and get that giraffe to lose its footing and fall down. That, for them, the lions will have then an unbelievable chance of catching. Hang on, everybody, I'm going to poke my nose over here because we've got, hang on, and reposition, the lion coming for a second go. Very keen, this female. She's obviously a young lioness. Look at this, look. Now we've got an unbelievable view, everybody. See what she's doing? She's trying to go around. And what a lion will do as well, it will try and jump on the back of the giraffe. I've never seen this in my life, everybody. In my life. How crazy is this? But she needs the help of her fellow teammates. And they didn't seem as keen to have giraffe on the dinner menu as this young lion, as she keeps licking her lips as well. Come on, girl. Yeah, you want to be careful, because if you get on the wrong end of this giraffe kicks her in the face, she could run the risk of breaking her jaw or even just killing her instantaneously. Look what she's doing. You see how she's trying to go around to the rump? And this is a huge male giraffe. He's fully grown. I mean, he's not really going to get any bigger than that, so she's being extremely brave. No ways. What? I did not wake up this morning thinking that I was going to see a lion try and hunt a giraffe. Sorry, everyone, we need to keep moving as well. No ways, no ways. This is not happening. This is not happening to me today. This is just too unbelievable, everybody. I can't believe my eyes. I dream of seeing things like this. So this is honestly a dream come true. Look at her, she's in hot pursuit. Come on, giraffe, cross the road in front of us so we can see. Everybody, take lots and lots of screenshots, because this is something that you're probably not ever going to see, or at least see for a very long time again. Like I said, it's taken me 5 years to see something like this. Come on, girl. Amazing. Everybody, I can't help myself but take a few photos as well, because this is just unbelievable. She keeps looking back as well to say, come on guys, where are you? And there's not another lion in sight, I'm afraid. She is all on her own, and I don't think all on her own she'll be able to take down this big male giraffe. This is unbelievable. I'm so absolutely flabbergasted. I can't believe what I'm seeing. Come on, girl. Give a little call for your friends. I think that you deserve, after chasing after this male giraffe, to have a little meal. Right? Are you tired now? You did a good run around. Good effort. The giraffe doesn't actually seem to be too bothered. He's just like, you're wasting your time, my friend. She keeps looking back at him. And he's just like, yeah, keep moving. I showed you. He's probably acting all big and tough now. Well done, mister. I don't think you expected to have that happen to you either this morning, Mr. Giraffe. It was unbelievable. He's keeping a close eye on that female now. It is amazing. Flamingo Nyam, the static at Twin Dams Pangolin Junction, is one on lock. So everybody, just updating the sighting very quickly. Copy, Aubrey, you'll be number two. Lovely, that is beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. Let's follow this lioness back. I don't know what to even say to any of you. That was an unbelievable sighting. I mean, how many of you have ever seen anything like that? I didn't even get to tell you that this is all live. I can't believe that. I mean, how incredible is that we just witnessed, right? Everybody's trying to get hold of me on the radio. Which river I was asking to be third vehicle? So go game with your game. Name? Yeah, Sipo, what's your luck? Copy, yeah, there's not lots of pressure, so just respond when you're a little bit closer. You can see she's everybody. I'm just letting everybody know what's happening with these lions. I'm so excited. I feel like I'm out of breath. The adrenaline is pumping through my veins at the moment. Whew, that was to die for. That is what we wait for. Every single day we come out in the bush hoping that we're going to be able to see something like that. And to see it live, I mean, that's amazing. Like I said, every single day I've been in the bush for 5 years now, and I've never seen anything like that before. I And I know it wasn't a success on this female lion's behalf, but how amazing was that? Good attempt. Elizabeth from Singapore wants to know if this female would be able to take down the giraffe with the help of the other females. Yes, indeed. And that's what this female was doing. She kept looking over her shoulder back in the direction of the rest of the pride, hoping that they were slowly making their way here. Anything is possible. Anything is possible with lions. Remember, they also had a big male quite close by. And with his help too, they definitely could have brought it down. The difficult part though with bringing down a giraffe, as I was explaining, is that they've got those powerful back legs. Now if one of those back legs connect with a lion, they're going to be in a lot of trouble. So what I've seen the lions do, and I've seen lots of footage in the greater Kruger areas, that they like to chase them over rocky areas, an area where they could potentially fall over. And then all the lions need to do is to sit on top of that giraffe, and that giraffe's not getting up again. So I think that's what she was hoping to do. Let's go back and just find the rest of the pride very quickly. They were just here because this other female is going to join up. Oh, okay, good. They haven't gone anywhere. I can still see them. Oh, right. The others are actually up and moving. Maybe they're going to come back and try again. Dina, you're quite correct. I'm having an unbelievable morning. I'm seeing so many new things for the first time. First the lunar moth, and now the lions trying to hunt, or a lion trying to hunt a giraffe. Now, have a look over here. The rest of the pride is now up. Can you see that? And hopefully the female is going to come through and she is going to communicate with them and say, hey guys, hey listen, there's some tasty giraffe meat just up ahead. Aren't you hungry? Because they don't look fat. The females don't look fat at all. I think it was a very small thing, whatever they caught, like I said earlier this morning. So they could do with another meal, especially with all these tiny little cubs. They need... Sorry, I need to fix my microphone again, everybody. So my hair, it's a standing joke now that my hair eats the mic. So please, I'm just going to apologize for Tuesday. Perfect. They can hear me now. I'm not sounding like I'm underwater anymore. See that? See how their bellies are not full? And now, remember, they're feeding all these little cubs. They need constant food so that they can produce enough milk so that these little cubs can get their daily nutrient requirements. Isn't that amazing? Yes, go back and hunt the giraffe because I want to see that again. And I'm sure all our viewers watching this want to see this again too. Nobody is going to believe me, but luckily this is all live and we do record it as well. I cannot wait to brag to every single person because this is honestly brag worthy of a sighting. I mean, this is, I can't believe it. I'm so speechless. I wish you could just feel the emotions that are going through my body right now. It was so amazing. Oh, look at this man. Look at the Birmingham, how this light is beautifully catching him. I want to just swing over and have a look at him. Oh, no, I said, I've just gone and told everybody how beautiful and regal you look in this lovely morning light, and then you go and you sit down. Thank you. That was not nice of you. Come on, we need your help. At least he's got his head up, I suppose. It could be worse. He could have just flopped on over. But that morning golden light is just so stunning. Now, Mr. Birmingham, I think you would look even more lovely on the back of a giraffe. I don't know. Who agrees with me? What an incredible morning so far. We could all just go home. And we've seen so much. Oh, something very interesting. I'm not going to spoil the surprise too much. Quickly head on over to Jamie, and I'm going to stick with the kahumas for a little bit.
I had something very interesting. Oh, there he is. Luckily, he decided to stick around. This crested barbet just had himself fully tucked away in a hole in the tree. And I'm just wondering if we haven't just found a crested barbet nest. How exciting. Morning! Sorry, I'm just saying hello to one of the Simbombili vehicles. Let's have a look at the hole that it just came out with. He's back in. He's back in. That's awesome. I wonder if it's building a nest. It could be building a nest. That is so cool. Tucking its way in. Ah. What has it got? It's got a beak full of something. It's excavating. I'm sure that's what it's doing. Look, it keeps going through and then dumping whatever's in there. I think it's making a nest. It's making a hole.
Turning off and on.
It's just the cable that needs jingling.
The cable needs jingling.
Oh dear, it's flashing red at me. It's back, it's back. Am I back? Marvellous. Sorry about that. We've had some slight microphone problems over the last few days. I'm not quite sure what's happening with mine. It's doing some strange things. So look at this. This barbet's going in. Remember how we've talked about crested barbets creating their own nests? It's obviously started with a hole that started to rot out, and he's pulling away, using that incredibly powerful beak, to strip away the inside of this tree, which is obviously a dead tree, it's a rotting tree, and he's decided that this is the perfect nest site. How cool is this? I've never seen this before. Look at it go! You see his legs struggling, this is amazing! Has it got a beak full of wood? Yes! It's exactly what it's doing. And up and drop it. Well, so that's what I say to Lexi most of the time, my dog. Yeah, pluff, pluff, pluff. How cool is this? This is absolutely incredible. I have never seen a barbet constructing its nest before. He must be scraping up the bark. Come on, do it again. Oh, flip, 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 flip. Mouth full of wood. Splinters in the tongue. Ah, the dedication. As spring is sprung. And our birdies are all happily making their nests, whether they be Shikra, Warburgs, or crested barbets. One more time for us. He's going to go. Oh, oh, he's going to stop. He's going to go. I'm sure he's going to go. Come on, one more time. What's he going to do, Dave? Is he going to go? Is he not? The joys of being a live wildlife cameraman. There he goes. And he's in again. Psyching himself up. Or herself. It could be a she. Impossible to tell. They're both committed to the nest building reproductive process. In you go. Come on. Hole's not going to wait. Well, might actually. It's probably not going anywhere. This is amazing. Here he goes. You can actually see from his body movements the scraping that must be happening inside there. Oh, this is so fantastic. We can watch this over the next few weeks. Remember when Scott found the lilac-breasted roller nest and we were able to have a little peek inside? Imagine if we keep coming back and see the barbets feeding their babies. This is too cool. Wow, I'm seriously dedicated. Just the tip of the tail. This is amazing. We are so lucky to be able to see this. Wow. There's a serious beakful that he must be gathering. And then, over the next few weeks, legs will be allayed. Now, Lucy, that's a good, very good point. Lucy's watching in South Bend, Indiana, and I keep saying he. It could be a she as well. As far as I know, Lucy, they both play a role. Although my suspicion is that the male will do most of the work in terms of nest construction. And the reason I say that is the general approach of most passerine birds. So things like weavers, here we go, up again, beak full of dirt, and there. This is so cool. The starlings have come to watch. Cheer him on. My suspicion is that it's a male, but I'm going to double check that. I'll look it up and find out. He might even chase these starlings away. Where's it gone? I've lost it now. Oh, there he is. Well done, Dave. So the starlings go. Lucy, I'll look it up. I'll try and find out which of the... I know they're cooperative breeders, so like most birds, the male does play a role in the chick's life. Unlike our mammal species, of course, where that's quite rare. But for birds, it's relatively common, and in fact, with crested barbets, they're part of the cooperative breeder collection. In other words, their chicks from the previous year might, or the same year... Oh, there it goes again. This is amazing. Such dedication. I could sit here and watch this all day. It's fascinating. Another beakful. That one wasn't quite as dedicated as the last. Up we go, and spit. Oh, he's keeping Dave guessing. Oh.
Hello.
He did. He's there now. He is. If you zoom in to the right of this funny dead combination of trees, keep going. Oh, zoom in there. There he is. Okay, maybe stop for breakfast. Tea break. I thought I saw a second one there as well. Oh, there is. If we go up a little bit, yeah. Is that lady crested barbet? There we go. There's our two crested barbets. This is awesome. So fascinating. Well, there you go. I learned something new today about the process of nest hole construction. And now we had two crested barbets. Now we've got one crested barbet. And I hope that this is of course the joy of the live safaris, is the continuity of the animal's stories. We actually get to follow them and share this little part of their lives. How cool was that? Well done, Dave. Epic, epic camera work. I've got the most exciting part of the news in all my thinking, and that's I found Karula's tracks coming back in with at least one cub. We know that both were fine yesterday, so I probably just missed the second set of tracks going across, but she's come back on, which is wonderful news. Spring is in the air, there's lion cubs, nesting birds. I'm waiting for it to come to see if it comes back, but I don't think it's going to. Nesting birds, leopard cubs somewhere on the property. Oh, what a marvellous day. I think our barbet is gone for now. Aqua, you want to know where I am, and yes, absolutely, I can promise you I won't forget to check again. We are on Twin Dams. Ngari Main is just here. We're in the newly constructed loop road around Twin Dams. There's the hole. Just one more closer. Ooh, clonk. Sorry, Dave, I've forgotten how to drive this morning. Here's the hole. This is going to be fascinating. Yes, birdie it is. It is a burnt tree, and that, I think, kill is what killed it. Or it might have been ringbarked, but I think it probably died in this whatever fire swept through here. I believe there was a big fire in this area. When was it? 3 years ago? 2 years ago. I'm not 100% sure, but I do know that this whole area bears the scars of a fire that's come through here. So it's a dead tree, and it's probably starting to rot, and the wood, that makes it perfect, because the wood's quite nice and soft and crumbly. It was at one point a silver cluster leaf, a living silver cluster leaf. And often what happens is fires burn through quite fast and the trees are fine. But when there's a big build-up of dead material around them and the fire's hot and static, if it's not a windy day, then it'll, the occasional tree will actually catch fire and die. Because you can see the tree behind it is fine. And I mean, it would have been alive at the same time as this fire that killed this tree. Might even have been dead already, but I don't think so. I think it was killed by the fire. What an awesome, awesome sighting. Really cool. Okay, let's go find the leopards now. So yes, we will be coming back to check upon this particular nest. I'm very curious to see what happens. I'm also very curious to see where Karula has gone. Tracks come back into the block between Weaver's Nest and Twin Dams, for those of you who are familiar with the geography of this area. That is a very, very big block. So we're going to have to concentrate hard here. I'm hoping, against hope, it's going to be as simple as driving along Elephant Carcass. We've seen the cubs there before, it's one of their favorite spots, and that Karula will just be there with her kill. I'm optimistic. I'm also just crawling along, checking the trees. And Karula is Karula really is a powerful leopard. All leopards are strong. The most impressed I have been with Karula in a while was the last kill we saw her with, where she had hoisted an adult female impala into a tree that was probably about 10 meters off the ground. And she must have done it very quickly, because that impala hadn't even been fed on yet. It was incredible. I mean, that's basically like lifting your body weight 10 meters up into a tree with your fingernails. Now, we know she can do it. It's just a matter of figuring out where she's done it. Sure. Awesome morning. Okay, I'm going to continue on my search. Tayla, of course, has got the amazing Nkuhumas in the spring morning. Head back there.
So we managed to find the Nkuhumas again. They did get up and move through some very thick vegetation again. They've actually moved closer towards where we left that male giraffe. He's not too far away from them. He's probably about 200 meters away and still watching closely, but they've moved into the thicket. As you can see, it's quite dense around here. So this would also be a good spot if they were going to plan a hunt, maybe later today or something along those lines. It would be a good spot to hide the cubs, just because there is a nice drainage line. There's lots of cover for all these little ones, lots of tumbuertis. It would be a good place to drop them off. However, some of the females are now obviously completely horizontal. Well, no, not that one. That one's doing yoga this morning, as you can see. Very flexible lines. And the rest of them are sort of laying down, heads sort of flat, and look like they're going to rest for a little bit. But they've been up and down for most of the morning. And it's not too hot yet. It's warm, but it's quite cool. There's a nice cool breeze coming through. Oh no, there we go, going flat. So possibly they're going to spend maybe some time here this morning just resting up. I really wish they would all get together and go and try and hunt that male giraffe, because I think between the six adults, they would definitely be able to bring down that big boy. And now that would give them enough food for about a week, that they wouldn't even have to think of hunting for an entire week. And it would be a humor. How great would that be for us? There'd be lots of hyena activity. So bringing down a big animal like that, as gracious as giraffe are, just imagine for these lions how happy they would be to be able to feed their cubs every single day, which would be lovely. Now they're tucked up nicely under a gwari tree. And I did set the lunar moth free, everybody. It caught the wind and it flew away. Oh, not happy with all the cubs suckling at once. See what I mean when I say that I think she's losing her tolerance for the youngsters. That's beautiful. Today has just been an absolute dream come true. Remember everybody, we are live, so if you'd like to interact with myself or with Jamie, you are welcome to send in some questions. You can either hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you are welcome to email us, and you can send an email through to questions@wildearth.tv, and we'll happily answer questions to our best ability. And those of you who are starting to get to know me, you know that I like to sometimes just sit quietly and observe. So I think we're going to take a moment after all the excitement we've had this morning just to sit and appreciate these lions. Hear all the crested Franklins as well shouting in the distance. A little bird party seems to be moving through in the drainage below us. Poor mom. She's not having a great time at the moment. Gutsy little lions. I remember when I did my interview drive here, I went out one morning with Jamie and we found the Styx Pride with all their little fluff balls. Well, back then they were more fluffy than what they are now. And we watched one female get covered by six of the little lion cubs trying to suckle from her. And that was hysterical to see. Eggsy, can you see? Is this a vulture that's flying up above us? Oopsie, yes, I think it looks like a... Is it a hooded vulture? Or is it an eagle? I cannot see. Oh no, we've got, it looks like a tawny eagle flying above us. And that's quite typical to see as the birds of prey, these bigger raptors, will actually fly, that are low flying, whereas the vultures tend to fly a little bit higher. Actually, it could be a Wahlberg's. Sorry, it's just straight above us, and it's actually not too big. Sorry, everybody, it's a Wahlberg's eagle. Now it's gone. We can't view it anymore. I was looking straight into the sun, and I just saw the silhouette of it. So excuse that incorrect identification. So what the Wahlbergs, what the tawny eagles and the bacheliers will do is they fly at a much lower level. And they actually look for something like lions or a leopard or a clan of hyena, anything like that. And maybe follow them. It's just checking, hey, do you have any scraps here? Do you have a carcass maybe? And if it does, if those lions did have a kill, it would then perch itself down on the tree and wait for those lions to move away. And then they'd come down. And they often, like I said, before the vultures even spot a kill, it's normally the bachelor eagles, the tawny eagles, and the Wahlberg's eagles that will find it. But I think this eagle is slowly realizing that there isn't anything here. I think you should hang around though, Mr. Eagle, because we're going to watch the lions kill a giraffe. Well, I'm being very optimistic. I'm hoping if I send positive vibes towards these lions, and not so positive vibes towards the giraffe though, I'm afraid, that they will get up and they will go and try again. Excuse me, everybody. The ladies in FC say bless you, thank you. Itchy little face. I actually like the older cubs, they're my favorite. They're just getting to the age now where they're extremely curious. And they have got a small sense of independence. Willow would like to know how often lions eat. Now Willow, unfortunately lions don't have the say as to when they eat all the time. They're not the best hunters, I'm afraid. So we call them opportunistic feeders. So whenever there's an opportunity to try and catch something, they will. So that means if they can catch something every single day, they're going to eat every day. Unfortunately, this is not the case though. When you have to rely on something like stealth in order to catch your prey, you are not as good of a hunter as, for instance, something like wild dog or hyena, who use stamina to run their prey into exhaustion. So the lions, I reckon out of every 10 times that they attempt to make a hunt, we already saw a missed attempt this morning, maybe they'll catch something 3 times. So ideally, if the lions could eat, say, a big buffalo every 3 or 4 days, they would be very, very chuffed with themselves. And then obviously mom would be producing lots and lots of milk for these little ones to suckle on as well. So Willow, I hope that answers your question. The opportunistic feeders, and they possibly, or if they could, they could eat something every 3 to 4 days, they would be very happy with that. See, their digestive systems work a little bit differently to ours. They gorge themselves. That stomach will expand multiple times. It looked like they swallowed a big beach ball. And slowly that will digest over a number of days. And if they are sitting on something like a buffalo, a big male buffalo that they've brought down, they'll eat until they can't eat anymore and they can barely breathe. And then they'll rest for a little bit, maybe go drink a bit of water just to help with the digestion. And an hour later, they'll get up and munch for 15 minutes and go to sleep. And that process will continue until there's absolutely nothing left of that buffalo carcass. Jay wants to know when lions and leopards are. Why do I mean put it like this, everybody, just to make it sound easy? So Jay has made a comment and wants to know why don't lions and leopards ever want to eat guides while they're sitting in the safari vehicle, even whether they've got a kill or whether they don't have a kill. We're not food to them. We don't look like food when we're in a game viewer. Remember, we've been interacting with these animals for such a long time now that they look at us and we're completely neutral. We sound like people, we smell like people, but we don't behave like them. So the people that they are used to are humans that are hunting them. So from the early settler days when they moved up and north and into these areas, they would have been shooting a lot of these different animals. So those are the people that they are used to. So it's taken us a long time to break this sort of trait that they are used to. So now, when we're in the vehicle, we just make a lot of noise and we laugh and we make some weird clicking sounds and we make, oh, cute, and all these strange little words and things like that. But we don't behave like the humans that they are used to, which is great for us. That's why they don't care. And that's why you can sit right next to a lion that's eating a buffalo and they won't mind at all. They'll actually get up and walk right past you. The cats are the most relaxed around the vehicles, and especially the lions. They really become quite easily habituated to the vehicle. So they are in no way tame. It's just that they are now used to us. But if you had to get out the vehicle, like for instance, if I got out the vehicle now and I started walking towards those lions, that's an absolute suicide mission. Firstly, it is very thick, like I've been saying. It's quite dense. So the lions won't have too much of an opportunity to get up and run away. Also, it's a few females that have got cubs. Now, they're going to be extremely protective over those cubs. And I would get myself into a lot of trouble. Not that you would ever want to get out of your vehicle when you have got any animals around you. Even if it's something like an impala, they're going to get a big fright and they're going to run away. And you don't really want to do that to them. So it's always good to keep your arms in the vehicle and keep your bums on your seat, and then you will be safe and you'll be able to get up close and personal with all the wonderful animals in Africa. Aubrey Taylor. Sorry, everybody, I just want to find out how much pressure is on the sighting. sure. Sorry, everybody, just trying to offer a nice view to some other guests, seeing as we've had such an amazing morning with the Nkuhumas. They're in a very tricky spot. They've got a drainage line on either side of them. They're sort of on a little island, and we're managing to view from one of the sides. How incredible was that, that we were the only ones this morning to catch them coming from the dam and spend so long with them, and I told everybody about it. And then to just be at the right place when they chase that giraffe. I mean, that is luck, and that's what safari is all about. It's a combination of being at the right place and the right time, and hopefully it's just your day. So Shelley from Arizona, good morning to you. And Shelley has asked me, do I think that the lions can sense the malnutrition in the different species of animals and therefore are trying to hunt bigger game? I think, you know, Shelley, lions and leopards are, or any of the carnivores, are naturally looking for the weaker animals. So for instance, in a buffalo herd, which lions tend to eat mainly in this area, they're looking for the buffalo that are hanging to the back of the herd and can't quite keep up with the stronger members that are in the front. And then, yes, they're going to go for animals like that. Or if they see one that's got a limp, that, like I said, that just isn't able to keep up with the healthier ones, they are definitely going to go for something like that. However, that giraffe we saw, he was in unbelievable condition. He was as healthy and as fit as a fiddle. So I think it was just an opportunity that he thought he was going, these lions thought they were going to try and take. So please excuse me for one moment. Go, Rexon. Rexon, I copied you 1 out of 5. And you can keep making your approach to this lock if you can also take over when you get here. Rexon, sorry, are you looking for Ngonyam? I'm with Nkuhumas. I think Jamie's got Nkonzo for Mafazi Ingwe. Sorry, everybody, I think we've got a bit of confusion. Yeah, I think these lovely ladies of the Nkuhumas and all their fluffy cubs have settled in for the morning. The weather's got all of a sudden very chilly. I'm actually going to have to put a jersey on, everybody. So if you hear a bit of ruffling, please. Sorry, I apologize. I'm just freezing to death all of a sudden. Let me just find my lovely jersey. So I apologize, everybody. I've got to put my lovely green jersey on because I'm absolutely frozen. The wind has picked up. You know, it's so strange. I know this time of the year, the August, September, is normally the windiest time of the year. So I suppose I can't complain too much. Okay, almost there. Oh, that feels better. Whew, now it doesn't feel like I'm in the Antarctic anymore. It's going to look nice and neat, so I better fold my collar over my jersey. There we go. Thank you, everybody, and apologies again. Oh, now I'm warm. That feels much better. So these ladies could just rest up for a little bit, and possibly they will, because it's so cool now, they may even get up and carry on and try and look for something to eat. Like I said, they haven't got full bellies, so they could eat again. Good morning, Andrew. Andrew wants to know if lions have a winter and a summer coat. And the answer to that is yes. Not anything that you would possibly be able to notice, but it's like your dog at home or your cat at home. In the cooler months, their coat gets a lot thicker and fluffier. And then in the summer months, they start to shed that hair. It's exactly the same. So with the constant grooming that the lions are doing, you probably won't see the big chunks of fluffy hair that comes up, but yes, their coat does thicken up in the cooler months, especially the cubs. You can see that fluffy little bundle of joy over there. It's going got a lovely winter's coat. But that's also just because he's quite young, they need that extra layer of warmth just to help keep them going through the chilly nights. Though it's not really cold, we didn't really have winter this year. I don't think so. It was a few cold mornings and a few cold evenings, and that was about it. And everything else in between was warm. They're fast asleep. And my favorite flat cats. I cannot moan this morning though. They gave us the most unbelievable sighting, everybody. The Nkuhuma pride. And these ladies are fast becoming my favorite lions of the Sabi Sands. My favorite was the Southern Pride, and I absolutely love all the different individuals that are in that pride. However, these ladies are incredible. And it's actually the same. The Southern Pride is also, it also consists of 5 adult female lions, and now they've also got 8 cubs, I believe. When I was there, I was only saw 4 of them. Did I see 4 of them? And so it's so nice to see that that pride is growing. They were about 22 strong at one point. And then, unfortunately, with the different males coming through, they ended up chasing off and killing a few males. Quite similar to what happened with the Birmingham takeover. Right, everybody. I think we're going to have to move out of this area. These lions are fast asleep. And I think we've just had an amazing, amazing morning with them. So I think it's a bit of an anticlimax now to sit and watch them sleep. I'm just going to reverse out of here. Let's go see if our friend the giraffe is still keeping a close eye out on these lions. So it won't take a moment. We're not really in any thick bush. But while I carry on, oh, I can still see our friend the giraffe. But let's head on over to Jamie and just see how she's going, if she's found anything else that's of interest this morning.
Alrighty, well, we're continuing on our leopard search, but I want to show you a picture that I was just sent. Hold on, let me get my screen a bit clean. I want to show you a picture that was just sent to me from a sighting this morning on Buffalo's Hook. Let's see what the reflection's like. Who does that look like to you? Those of you familiar with our lions, who does that look like? I know who I think it looks like. And if we have a look, he's got his buddy with him, who is much, much smaller and looking very much like a teenage male lion. And hashtag over it. Hashtag over it. That is a fantastic nickname. Right, so hashtag over it. I hope you're not over this. I think that's Junior, personally. It's obviously, it's a photo of a photo, so it's impossible to get the full detail and clarity. I think that's Junior, in which case he's with his new buddy, whoever his new buddy may be. Obviously, I'm going to ask for the original of that photo so that we can check spot patterns and so on. Looks like Junior to me. That Nkuhuma male line. Yeah, I think it's him. So there we go, Junior. You've just been with the Nkuhuma Pride. For new viewers, Junior is their sub-adult male. Hello. What's happening here? Hold on one moment, I'll explain this in a sec. Do you smell something? I smell something. I'm trying to get onto the Game Drive channel to find out what Aubrey's looking at. Oh. What did he see? This is where we had our Marshall Eagle. It's very selfish of me, but I would really like to get onto the Game Drive channel right now. Patience. Right, sorry, Junior, the Nkuhuma male, was around when I first started working here with the Nkuhumas. With the takeover of the Birmingham boys and with his natural aging process, it was time for him to go, as male lions do, to disperse, set off, look for his own territory. Unfortunately, he was all on his own. So, very bemused. What were they looking at? Yes, so it was time for him to disperse. This is where the marshal was. I'm wondering if it's not him somewhere. I don't see it. Too many things happening. What was here? Must have been that Marshall Eagle. I'm sure it's still hanging around. Oh my goodness! I'm just waiting for my opportunity to ask Aubrey. So Aubrey's come to help me look for Karula. Oh, that's quite nice. Something to look at while I wait for my turn on the game drive comms is a hoopoe. We've had some nice sightings of hoopoe recently. Whoop whoop. Oh, it's calling. Awesome. Whoop whoop. Unfortunately, it's a little bit windy, but it's an awesome image. Whoop whoop. Whoop whoop whoop. I think the hoopoe is one of the best named birds of all of them. Out of all of them. I'm not sure whether or not you agree. I think hoopoe sounds exactly like what they say. What else is a really good bird name? I like the name Batelier because of the meaning behind it. Definitely the hoopoe, one of the best bird names that we get out here. Or maybe they were looking at the Nyala. I'm not quite sure why. I mean, not why they were looking at Nyala. Nyala are lovely. Why they would have been there. Determined to see if there's something here. And Marisha, I did say I could smell something, and it was a smelly smell. It was not a good smell, it was a smelly smell. And I wonder, yesterday we had that Marshall Eagle on the ground and we couldn't see anything. But I wonder whether it wasn't the remains of a meal that it had managed to catch. I saw some Legavan or Rock Monitor tracks around there. And Marshall Eagles regularly regularly catch monitor lizards. And I'm wondering if it wasn't that, but I don't know why he would have abandoned it. Oh my goodness, this is a popular road today. Here comes Rex and everybody. Let us say hello to him. Good morning. How's it? How are you? Hello, Rex. Hi, guys. Oh, goodness. Okay, awesome. I'm not sure if I didn't check further along if she didn't cross south. I just came round, did a loop. But I'll check around. Okay. Cheers, guys. Bye. I know you're all dying to see Rexon, and I'm sorry. We couldn't put him on camera there because he had a guest sitting next to him on the passenger seat. And we don't put people on camera without their permission. So we can't do it. So that's why it wasn't we were being rude. That was why... There's Nyala. Maybe that's what they were looking at. Here he is. Hello, boy. Okay. Well, the wonderful news is as our Nyala disappears, Rex is going to pop a tracker on our tracks, on the tracks that we need. Of course, as you know, Rexon is exceptionally good at tracking things, and I think that his tracker is called Big Amos. I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure I met him once before long ago. I think his tracker's name is Big Amos. Big Amos is not a small man. Fair enough name. Okay, we're going to carry on. In the meantime, Taylor's been very fortunate. She's managed to catch up with that giraffe. Let's go and see if its heart's still beating rapidly or if it has recovered from its ordeal.
We have indeed caught up with our friend Giraffe. If you have a look just over there, he doesn't seem too bothered at all. And he's not far away from the lions. He's actually just moved now. He's only moved about 10 meters from where we left him earlier this morning. And he's now munching away. He was ruminating earlier. He's obviously now got some space for some new leaves. Hello, boy. I can't believe you're hanging around here, Mr. Giraffe. I thought that you would have booked it after those lions left you, after that female lioness left you alone. He's very calm. Maybe he's experienced a few lions in his life and he knows that they're all talk and no action. I don't know. Does anybody know if the Nkuhumas have ever brought down a giraffe before? Because it does take some skill and practice. I know in Namibia there are prides of lions there, if only a few prides that are specialists in killing giraffe. It does take some technique. Hello? Yes, I would also look over your shoulder if I was you, just to make sure that those lions aren't coming back for a second opportunity. See, just having a little check. Make sure they've got really good eyesight. Being so tall, they can see over the tops of the trees. You see, he is upwind of the lions, so I don't think his hearing is really working so well. He would be able to hear those lions coming, so he is really be able to smell them coming. He's really having to just keep peeping over his shoulder. But we saw those lions, they were fast asleep. So I don't think for the next few hours they're going to do anything. Hopefully he does remember not to go walking over that way again. Otherwise that one female is definitely going to get up, I think, and have another go. He's looking quite intently though in the distance. Right, now he's chewing again. Look at that sort of big callus on the front of his head. So yesterday I was telling you about how the giraffe, especially the male giraffe, get these calcium deposits on their head as they start to age. And that's also just to help protect their head. It's almost like a little bit of a helmet, because remember, they are swinging their necks around at other males when they're competing for females. So you need a little bit of added protection. It doesn't look like much, but think of it like a big 30 kilogram weight dangling from a rope. Now imagine swinging that into something. It would cause quite a bit of distraction. So if another male giraffe swings his head and hits a giraffe square on the chest, it's going to be a huge blow and could definitely, if it hits hard enough, knock a giraffe down. I've never seen a real giraffe fight before. I've only ever seen young males sparring, but that's amazing enough. I want to try and reposition, just because we haven't got the greatest light at the moment. So I'm just going to back up and try and change the angle. I'm just going to poke my nose off the road just like this, just so that anyone who wants to come past, they can come past. There we go. I think that's a little bit better. A little bit, but we have got the sun behind us. But you can see how nice and dark he's going. If you start at his head and you work all the way down to his legs, you can actually see, look how lovely and dark those patches are coming through now. So he's really in the prime of his life. And as the giraffe start to get older, they start to produce more testosterone, and that's with all the different animals. Some animals show the enhancing of the color a little bit better, being giraffe, I think, show it the best. And he's only going to get darker and darker for here. I've seen some amazing giraffe in the Sabi Sands where they're black in color. And I couldn't believe it, because I've never seen such dark giraffe before. And that's when you know. Or if you've ever heard the saying, tall, dark, and handsome out here in the bush, that is true. Munching. Sonia from Australia, g'day mate. I'm joking, I'm allowed to say that because I have an Australian passport. My entire family, most of my family lives in Australia. So Sonia, I hope you're having a grand old day. And Sonia wants to know, how long do giraffe live for? They have a relatively long lifespan. They don't live more than about 28 years. Now, I suppose there's an exception to every rule, but around there, anywhere between 25 and 28 years. So this bull, I would say he is in his late teens, early 20s, just because I definitely think he's in the prime of his life at the moment, but he could still get a little bit darker in color. I don't think he'll get much taller. He's sort of at his absolute maximum height, but it's just the colors that can get a bit darker now. He doesn't have too many scars on him either, so I think he's been in a few arguments, but I think he is in fantastic condition and he's healing quickly if he does get into any battles. But the real old male giraffe, the ones that have been around forever, I don't know if Eggsy, if you can zoom into his, where his elbows and knees would be. Let's go to his front legs. Now, normally, over there was a really, really old male. You actually see all this calloused skin forming around that joint in the front. And that's normally because their front legs take all the beating when they are fighting as well. So that's also quite something else you can look at to see how old boy is. That's why I say I think he's coming into the prime of his life now. Lovely young, lovely strong boy. Good morning, Shabbat from North Carolina. Shabbat wants to know, when giraffe give birth, do the calves fall from all the way up there, or do the mothers actually lay down and give birth? Well, Shabbat, your initial thinking is correct. A female giraffe will just stand and push the little one out, and that drop to the ground is actually what makes the young calf take its first breath. So it sort of kickstarts the lungs in order to get them to work again. So it's quite a hard drop. And they are fine though. Remember, the animals are so resilient, so they'll drop to the ground and then mom will help clean them up. And with about 30 minutes to an hour, they'll be up and starting to try and learn to stand. Mr. Giraffe, I'd be very careful about walking anywhere near a drainage line if I were you, because the direction that you're going in now is back towards the lions. And also, remember how I was saying, that would be a good place for the lions to try and hunt the giraffe, because it will be very unlevel sort of land and make it easier for those lions. Just take one mistake, one putting a foot in the wrong hole and falling over to end this giraffe's life. And he is a lovely specimen. Look, I love the way that they sort of purse their lips when they go in to get a leaf. Look at that. It sort of does a little puckering. Look there. That's really funny. Now he's looking over. There's another vehicle coming past us. So he's just glancing on over, making sure it's not a lion. Sonia. Sonia from Australia wants to know how long a giraffe's tongue is. Now everybody, like Jamie was chatting about this yesterday morning actually. We're not really seeing much of the tongue now. We're just seeing a little bit poking out. And I believe their tongues are around 40 centimeters. Look at that chewing there. What I really love though is when giraffe ruminate. That's probably my favorite thing to sit and do when you've got nice light, because you can actually see the ball of partially digested leaves going up and down their throats, which is quite funny. So you can see the peristalsis, the movement of the food moving up and down. But not today. Maybe you can see it swallow when it finished chewing these leaves. Actually quite a pretty male giraffe. Ah, Eggsy, can you go into the front joints again of that giraffe? I just want to see, because you can see the front. See there? You go all the way in. See what I mean when I say you can start to see the calluses forming on the skin there? Now it'll cover the entire joint and it'll almost become like a shin pad, I suppose. But you can see he's in good nick still. Good morning, Bill. Bill wants to know if it's true if giraffe and mice have the same number of vertebrae in their neck. Now, Bill, I'm not sure how many vertebrae a mouse has. That's actually something I've never been asked before, so I'll have to look that up for you. However, I do know how many vertebrae a giraffe has in its neck, and it's actually exactly the same amount that we have in our neck. So there are 7 vertebrae in their neck. Can you believe it? However, they are just much larger than ours, as you can imagine. They are really, really big. That's something quite interesting to see. I'm not sure if we've got a giraffe vertebrae in the tent. Maybe we do. If we don't, we'll have to keep an eye out for one. See, this giraffe really isn't utilizing its tongue at the moment. This tree that it's feeding on doesn't have any thorns. So it's really just using its mouth, a little bit of its tongue, and pulling the leaves off. That tongue is very important when it starts feeding on a tree that's got lots of thorns. They need that tongue to try and get in between all the prickly bits. But now it's not necessary, so it's sort of taking a break. But Mr. Giraffe, your mother did not teach you any table manners. See how it is talking with its mouth open? Chewing with its mouth open. Obviously, you have to talk with your mouth open if you want any sounds to come out. This is what I sound like when I don't open my mouth and I try to talk. Good morning, Justina. Justina, you're a new viewer. I hope you enjoyed the show this morning and I hope we hear from you. Over the next few years, you must continue watching the show. So Justina wants to know, what are the horns on the giraffe's head made of? Now, Justina, they're not actually horns. The definition of a horn is a bony protrusion with a keratin coating around it, and the horn part mainly being the keratin. Now, there is no keratin on those little bony things coming out of their head. So that we call them ossicones, and it's really just bone that you're seeing there with skin and then hair coating on the outside. Maybe, Eggsy, let's have a look at the top of his little ossicones. We'll try and get in there. Now if you go all the way in, you can see there it's just bone, and you can actually see it, the top of his bone, it's slightly exposed. Every now and then we can see it, but he's now hiding behind the tree. So normally the females have long tufts of hair covering that, but now with the males it's quite nice, you can see how it's exposed. See that? So it's all just bone. Thank you, that was awesome. He's always looking around. He's now looking a little bit further north just to check that no one's trying to make it a sneaky attack, but I don't think so because I haven't heard anything on the radio of the lions getting active. They seem to still be sleeping, and the wind is really coming through now, so I don't blame those lions for going into that nice thick drainage line to have a little sleep. I'm quite impressed that Mr. Giraffe is still out. Normally the animals don't enjoy the wind so much. They'll move off into the denser vegetation. I just think it's amazing that we've seen so much play out this morning. First those lovely lions, and then not sure what the one female was looking at. She was curious, and then to have Mr. Giraffe come pushing through some trees. And I don't think he expected to be chased by the lions this morning. And now to have him so calm and relaxed and eating. It's quite funny how life is when you're living in the wild. I don't know. If I was maybe chased by lions, I don't know if I could go and have breakfast. I think I'd maybe give it a skip. I'd be so frightened. Absolutely having a grand old time. Oh, there we go. Look at that. Now you can see that tongue nicely. chewing away. I love how... I absolutely love how all those leaves go to the cheeks and sort of bunch up a little bit on the side. That's really funny to see. Go on, take a few mouthfuls so we can see that. Lum, lum, lum. No, can't get that piece in. Is that a bit tricky? Oh, no, I didn't like that. Maybe a few too many twigs. Beautiful. Asker wants to know how long a giraffe can go for without food and water. Now, Asker, they need to keep eating on a regular basis. So these giraffes are, like many of the other antelope species in the African bush, are ruminants. So like cows, they have a four-chambered stomach. So they need to try and eat all the time so that they can keep sort of digesting that food as it goes. See, their digestive system is really, really good. So it's a long process of trying to digest it. So like now we can see this giraffe is actually eating leaves. Just before we got back to the giraffe, we actually saw him ruminating. So what that means is that he will regurgitate partially digested leaves that have gone through the first chamber of the stomach, and then it will regurgitate them up. And normally they'll do this when they're resting, and then you'll see them chewing and chewing and chewing and swallowing and then regurgitating some more and chewing and chewing and chewing. And that process normally takes about 24 hours before they will try to re-chew that part, those partially digested leaves. And then after that, it then goes into the other chambers of the stomach for the final digestion process. So the food, the leaves that he's eating at the moment, he'll probably only regurgitate them and re-chew them this time tomorrow sometime. So I'm not sure how long they could go without water for. See, some of the leaves that they're eating, especially in the summer months, they are getting a lot of water from their leaves. I don't think giraffes have to drink every single day. I'm actually not 100% sure of that. That's what I love about this job, is that you can just never know anything, and sometimes you forget things too. It also just proves that we are only human. So I'm not 100% sure on that question. I can just sort of give a few little points from what I've seen. So maybe they can go without water for a day or two, but they need to continuously keep eating. That's the most important thing, is that they spend their whole days eating. That's all the herbivores do, is they eat and eat and eat and eat. Very little resting involved. And there is also always food around for the giraffe and for the different animals too. Now at this time of the year might not be as much, and they might not have their favorite trees, but there is definitely still things for them to eat. Now, if you had to have a big fire or something come through this area and say burn all 8.5 million acres of land, then you may have a problem. Then there probably won't be any food for the animals. All the grass will be burnt, all the leaves will be burnt off the trees, depending on the extent of their fire. But for now, this giraffe doesn't have to worry about anything like that. Oh, didn't like that very much. Sorry, Ben, I got so distracted by watching that giraffe try and take that bunch of leaves out of its mouth. You go down for more. Just to know, are lions really a threat to a giraffe, or would it depend on how many there were? So earlier today, if you're watching the show, we actually watched one female lioness chase this giraffe that we're looking at around a little bit. And that young female lion was extremely ambitious, and she would never be able to bring such a big giraffe down on her own. Maybe if it was a giraffe calf, yes. So Debbie, it depends on how many lions you have. If it was a giraffe that was very sick and very ill, and maybe it was sitting down, then yes, I think one lion could take it on. no problem. But this is a very healthy male giraffe, so she would have definitely needed the help from the other members of the pride. I have heard stories, though, of big male lions bringing down big male giraffe all on their own. So I think that that is definitely possible, but with a male lion, not with a female lion. Yum, yum, yum. I'm starting to feel a little bit hungry now. So, Carlo from California, the land of great wine, would like to know, can giraffe defend themselves with those ossicones, those little horns that we're seeing on top of their heads? I've never seen a giraffe swing its head at a potential predator. So, Carlo, I don't think that's what they're mainly used for. They mainly use those ossicones to fight other male giraffe during the mating season. So, giraffe will mainly use their very powerful legs to defend themselves from predators. They can chop forward with their front legs like a horse, and they can also use their extremely powerful back legs to kick. And if you've ever seen a horse or a donkey or a zebra double barrel, a giraffe can do the same thing. Even just with one of those legs, if a giraffe kicks a predator in the face, it will be lucky enough to get away with a... Actually, I'm going to tell you an interesting story before this. I'm going to bring up a photo. I'll need to look for one, though, of a male lion, one of the Charleston male lions. And him and his brother, this is down in the southern sector of Wasabi Sands, southwestern corner. Him and his brother actually brought down a big male giraffe, probably similar to like the one that we're looking at now. And they were successful in bringing it down. However, the one male lion, my favorite male lion in the whole of the Wasabi Sands, he obviously got kicked in the face, or he was either chopped in the face by the front legs while trying to bring down this giraffe, and he got one of his canines knocked straight out of his mouth. Can you believe that? And his tooth actually dangles down the side. It hasn't fallen off, and it's been like that for about 6 months now, because quite a bit of flesh came off of it. But don't worry. He is fine. He's healthy. He still brings down buffalo. It hasn't affected him in any way. He is just the most amazing lion to photograph because he looks like a gangster. They call him Toothy just because of his dangly tooth. So he was very lucky. So I think if it was any more of his foot on that poor lion's face, he probably would have got a broken jaw and then would have died from those injuries. I don't think you can come back from a broken jaw out in the bush, because you need to eat, you need to drink water. So he was extremely lucky. So if you ever get an opportunity to see the Charleston male lions, keep an eye out for the one with the canine that's dangling out of his mouth. And you know what's the perks of having a long tongue is that you can also use it to clean your nose. Ugh. Just got an image of that. I'm glad we don't do that. Righty, everybody, I think this giraffe has had a great time and has actually given us a good view from running away to the lions to now feeding on the shrub. Let's go see how Jamie's doing in the search for Karula.
Well, since the moment that I discovered Karula's tracks, I've had my vehicle in low range, and I'm trundling along at the slowest possible speed. I could walk faster than I'm going, and that's because I really, really don't want to miss any tracks. Now, the trackers are on Karula's and her cubs' tracks, heading in this direction. We're on Mumba Road, Aubrey's checking Leadwood, and essentially our job now is to make sure that we don't miss tracks crossing the road, so that we don't waste the trackers' time. If I find tracks coming across Mumba, I can call the guys and say, come this way. She's already crossed. Then they don't have to waste time going from track to track to track to track. So we're leapfrogging them to get a little bit ahead and to make sure that the leopards haven't crossed around us. I suspect she's in the drainage line between Leadwood and Mumba Road. And the reason I think that is those tracks that we had of her cubs and Karula came out of Little Gowrie, but I didn't have any tracks of her crossing south. So she must have crossed further to the east, where she'd made her kill, then looped around, gone back and fetched the cubs. That's what we've got to figure out. It's like a piecing together bits of the clues to come to a conclusion. And speaking of clues and conclusions, thank you to James Richard, who read the article about the wood hoopoes smelling like rotten meat when the female lays and raises a brood of chicks. And I'd forgotten that piece of information. I did know about it, but I'd completely forgotten about it. So maybe that's what I smelt that was a little bit unpleasant. Could also have been a carcass flower. I haven't seen any while I've been on Juma, but there's a type of flower that grows and gives off the scent of rotting meat. Could have been lion scat, leopard scat. I didn't stop for too long to investigate. It might even have been the remains of that martial eagle, if the martial eagle killed something. So because we're so fresh hot on these tracks, and because the fact that Karula went to fetch her cubs and bring them back here almost inevitably means that she has a kill, we're continuing the search as quickly as possible. We've only got an hour to track down and find the Queen of Juma. But I'm excited. I think she's here somewhere. We've got a very, very good chance of spotting her. We just have to keep checking. Checking the trees, checking the ground, and checking the eastern boundary just in case. Now, Kristen, as we drive along our own little portion of the Sabi Sand, I say our own, we don't own it, but it's our little patch, you want to know how big the Sabi Sand is in total. And the answer, unless I'm very much mistaken, it's around 65,000 hectares. Might be 66, but it's around 65,000 hectares. 65,000 football fields, roughly, give or take. Oh, that's a baboon. Almost got fooled by that track. Almost. So 65,000 hectares, my acreage conversion is appalling. What would that make it? 65,000? Would that be... Acres are smaller. So therefore it would be... I think they're about half the size of a hectare. Half the size of a hectare. You know, roughly 130,000 acres. Am I wrong? Sorry for those of you who are far better at conversions than I am. I thought of another bird, by the way. And just while we search for Karula's tracks and anything else on Cheetah Cutline, I thought of another bird that is very well named, and that's the hardy-dar. Because it's also for their call. Hardy-dar! Hardy-dar! That screeching cry that they make as they fly along. Can probably go up to third now. Right. This is the make or break moment. We're on the eastern boundary of our traverse area. We can't go into Torchwood. And I'm hoping that we don't find a set of leopard tracks casually wandering across. I'm really hoping. Come on, Karula. This morning when I went out on the Sunrise Safari, I was driving around quarantine, and Louise, who is directing us today, Louise said to me, it almost looks like a Mars landscape. It's so incredibly dry. And it does. I've never ever seen the bush look like this. Yes, it's the end of our dry season, so it always looks a bit dry, but nothing like this. And Snoop, you were wondering, when does it usually rain? You were saying it looks like a desert landscape, and that it's quite sad, and it is sad, it's unbelievably sad. It usually rains, our big rains usually come towards the end of October, sometimes even November. This year we're really hoping for early rains. We get the odd smattering in September and the beginning of October, but generally it's around the end of October that the proper rains kick in, and we get those afternoon thunderstorms. And the heat, it's usually so nice in summer because it gets hot, yes it gets very hot, but the heat builds and builds, and then it breaks in the form of a thunderstorm, and there's lots of rain, and it gets all pretty and green, and I'm really hoping, because we didn't have that last year, I'm really hoping that this year is going to be different. Let's just keep going. I want to see where she crossed out to get those cubs. It might give us a better indication as to where to start looking. Let's try and figure this one out. I'm hoping, Dave is betting on Monday, I said the 23rd of October. I wasn't nearly as optimistic. Brian said the 20th of September. That's not far away either. I'm just desperately, desperately hoping it will come. And of course, it's not so much the lack of water, although that's, if we were not pumping the dams, then the animals, we wouldn't be seeing anything, I don't think. If we weren't pumping the dams, there would be no water here. But it's more about the lack of food. You do drive around and there's just nothing. Except for the predators, of course. The Nkuhumas abandoned that buffalo kill last night. They just left it. And as far as we can tell, there's no reason why they did. If they'd been under normal circumstances, they would have stayed and fed off it for a while. Maybe they were threatened by hyenas, and with the cubs they thought it was prudent. But it does just go to show that the predators are having... I wouldn't say it's a wonderful time, but they are definitely coming out on top of this drought. And then hunting a giraffe just because. Okay. I know what we'll do. We'll take that two-track that leads to the old hyena den on Gowrie Main. See whether she isn't around there. Ooh, goodness, that's higher than we've had in a while. For now, the weather reports are saying a 40% chance of rain in the northern Sabi sand. Oh, everybody, we've got to keep our fingers crossed and really seriously hope that that actually comes to be. I really hope we get some rain. I think we're all going to go and stand outside in it. Do little happy rain dances. And now? Something tells me they might have been found. Hold on a moment. Did I miss something on the game drive comms? How's the dwarves? Hello everybody. They told them.
Yeah, just follow me.
Okay.
Call,
I know, I'm coming. Hey, orbs, you legend, you. I'll explain that conversation in a moment. Oh my goodness, he said follow me. Sounds like a challenge. As he races ahead. Oh, we better put ourselves out of low range. Let's try that again. They got them. Are we excited? Yes, we're excited. We must have been so close, Dave. Okay, while we play catch Aubrey, let's go back across to Taylor.
Well, everybody, I haven't got anything exciting to show you at the moment. I think we were so lucky this morning, and I am so happy with what we've seen today. It's incredible. So I'm just doing a bumble. I'm also learning the roads. We are on Savage's track at the moment, everybody. And I've looked on my map and it says I must take my next right. So I don't know where it's going to take me, but we'll find out while I slowly learn the northern Sabi sands, which is interesting. But we haven't seen anything just yet. And the wind is now horrific, unfortunately. So I don't know how much more we're going to see this morning. Hopefully we get some zebras, that'll be nice. We love the zebra, especially after yesterday, though the zebra will have a hard challenge to try and top yesterday afternoon's sighting at Red Dam, because that was quite spectacular. Oh, we've got a little water buck. Let me go back quickly, because that was a better view. Very well camouflaged. I don't know, can we see it through there? Or have we got lots of sticks and branches? But it's running away. Very young water buck calf. I don't know if I can see it. Let's see, I'm going to just switch off. Can you see it disappearing down there? My. So it's a, I don't know if you can see it through there. It's just slightly moving to the bottom right of your screen. You go, oh, there were two. Oh, maybe they've joined up to another one. Maybe it is mom and calf that I saw, because I thought I did see just another one as well. Okay, never to fear then. We can't really see them. Let's move on then, seeing as this waterbuck does not want to be viewed, so we don't want to view the waterbuck then. Fine, you have a nice day. Let's carry on up a little bit further. I do see quite a few zebra tracks as well on the road. And possibly we're going to bump into some of the stripy animals. Right, what else do we have here? No birds. I think the birds are going to be all hiding now, trying to keep out of this wind as well. Look at this big hole in this termite mound. Can you see that? It's crazy. This is a really, really big termite mound. It's probably about 3 or 4 meters tall. Now, I'm not going to go up and look inside that termite mound because I don't want to be surprised by an animal. So that big burrow would have most likely been initially dug out by an animal called an aardvark, the elusive anteater, which we sometimes, if we're very lucky, get to see at night. And they actually feed on the termites that you'll find inside this mound. But they also will be used, these holes, these burrows, will be utilized by other animals too. So something like a warthog will use a burrow like this, will come in and actually widen it slightly. And I didn't see any spider webs, so I can't see the sun catching any spider webs. So I think it could be an active little burrow, but I'm not willing to risk my life to see what was actually living inside there. But remember, if it was a warthog would actually reverse into that burrow and so that it can face its predators with its tusks. Now, probably some of you are thinking it doesn't look very deep, but it's actually quite a steep entrance, and I could probably wiggle my way in. I think Jamie could probably crawl around quite easily inside this burrow. So remember, just while you're out in the bush, as inquisitive as you are and as excited as you may be and you'd want to go and investigate, be very careful, because you would not want a warthog or even an aardvark charging out at you. You could really get a serious injury from that, but nothing as of yet. Wouldn't surprise me actually if there were some warthogs inside something like that on a very chilly day today. I also want to go back to bed. Normally the days warm up. Ah, everybody, I'm going to see you later. I'm not even going to ruin the surprise. I'm going to let Jamie have so much fun with Karula the Queen.
Oh, that was very South African. Sorry. Look what we've got here. Munching away on a dacre kill, one of Karula's gorgeous little cubs, and judging by the size, I'm going to say that's Hosanna, the little male. Look how big you got. Whoopsie. How big they've got. Nearly tumbled out of the tree there. Oh, this is so awesome. This is absolutely fantastic. Hey, Dave, I said they'd be between the drainage of Leadwood and Mumba. Admittedly, they're, you know, just off Leadwood. But still, this is absolutely wonderful. Look at it. Look at him repositioning the carcass. We can't get any closer right now. It's quite a tricky sighting. And Aubrey and Rex, who were the ones responsible for finding it, their trackers, are currently taking prime position, which is only fair in this sighting. Oh, this is so wonderful. Oh, you're going to drop it, mister. You are going to drop it. You're strong, but not that strong. Jamie can't get it back into the tree. Well done, Karula. She was successful after all. This is so great. Been dying to see these cubs for ages. I've only seen the little one in the tree. For the moment, I don't know where the queen is or where the other cub is. They might be elsewhere. They might just be lying up in the drainage line. Looks as though Karula's eaten most of the kill, or they've eaten most of the kill over the night. There's not all that much left. Well done, Karula. When we saw her yesterday, she was desperately hunting, looking incredibly hungry. And now she's managed to provide for herself and her 2 7.5-month-old cubs. For new viewers, I would like to introduce you to the royal family, as James calls them. Karula, the queen of Juma, somewhere at the base of the tree, presumably. And I'm... correct me if I'm wrong, I think this is the little male. She's got 2 cubs, 1 male and 1 female. Hosanna, the male, and Shongile, the little female. It's gonna go. You're gonna drop that out of the tree. And Justina says, is that a fox? The dead tree, the dead thing in the tree, not the leopard. No, it was a dacre. It is now not very much. You can just see the horns whenever he lifts up that head. He's currently feeding off the face of the animal. So you've got the jaw and the nose there. It's always a little bit macabre, these sightings, so apologies if you've got a little bit of a squeamish stomach. Oh, there we go. You can sort, I don't know if you could see there, the horns of the dacre. Definitely looks like it was a dacre, not a steenbok, just judging by the shape of the head. Mister, you are going to drop that onto the ground. There we go. So, it all went according to plan, didn't it, today? Said we're going to look for tracks, and if she comes back with cubs, then she's got a kill somewhere. And that was that. The Queen of Juma proving once again why she is such a good mom, providing for her little ones. Too cool. Amazing how a 7-month-old, fully weaned, they were fully weaned at 3 months old. Fully weaned and able to crunch through bits of small bone and meat. I saw a report yesterday from one of the other guides that Hosanna caught a dwarf mongoose. I don't know if it was yesterday or the day before, but he caught a dwarf mongoose. The dwarf mongoose let rip with a serious scream, and Hosanna dropped it and it disappeared off down a burrow. And it just goes to show already that hunting instinct is incredibly keen. And we have many scenes to look forward to as the little cubs start to practice their hunting skills. Stalking and catching things like Franklin and scrub hare and mongoose. There's a lot of talk a couple of months ago as to whether or not Hosanna, 2 months ago or so, had caught his first or made his first kill. There was a dead scrub hare in the sighting. But of course, we weren't sure who had managed to do that. Now, hopefully, we don't have limited time with these cubs. They're obviously going to be lots of vehicles. Sorry guys, I just need to listen to the Game Drive channel. I'm just waiting for my opportunity to chat. Sorry guys, I'm just waiting for an opportunity to, oopsie, chat on the Game Drive channel. Okay, let's reposition. I think we can now. wonderful way to start the morning. Rex, Orbs, are you happy for me to make my way in as well? Copy, thanks. Okay, we're gonna have to do some maneuvering quickly, but it shouldn't be too far. Too difficult, I'm hoping. I just want to make sure that Chungile is not... Ow! That was sore! Make sure that we don't frighten any of the remaining cub, wherever she may be. Check carefully. How's your view there, Dave? Perfect. Okay, I still can't see the other two, but we do have a brilliant view of the leopard cub feeding off what's left of the dacre. I'm impressed with him. Look, he's managed to get it back into the tree. Very impressive. Well done. Where's Karula now? Am I missing something? Let me see where the guests are looking. Oh well. We'll settle with our view for now. They must be further into the drainage line. Two very well-fed leopard cubs. You know what strikes me now in terms of size? When I first saw the tracks coming across, I thought it was Karula doubling back and then walking back again. That's how big the cubs' paws have got. At 7.5 months old, and I assume it's the male's tracks, Hosanna's tracks are the size of his mother's, which is very impressive because he's not quite there just yet. And it just goes to show the size difference between a male and a female leopard is very apparent, even at a couple of months old. And when we first saw them, they were sort of equal-sized bundles of fluff. And then as they got to about 4 or 5 months old, we started to notice the difference between the male and the female cub. And now it's become very apparent. Male cubs do just grow a little bit faster. They're also slightly more aggressive when it comes to feeding off the kills. So often the male cub will take first preference and then the female will come in second. This is all very complicated up here, isn't it, Mister? It's a slippery tree. You've got to keep your balance. Practicing those all-important leopard skills. Now, James Richard, you were wondering at what age a leopard is no longer described as a cub. And then obviously they've got the sub-adult, the sub-adult description and then the adult description. It's up for debate in terms of how we refer to things. We still refer to them as cubs when they're a year old. We actually still refer to them as cubs when they get close to about 14, 15 months old. Then we start to... Just waiting for it to come tumbling out of the tree. The kill, not the cub, obviously. I don't want the cub to fall out of the tree. So we still refer to Tiani as Saleheshe's cub, even though she's about 15 months old now. And now that Saleheshe is mating again, we probably start to refer to her as a sub-adult. And then when they reach independence and they mate for the first time, for females, that will be them as an adult. And when we consider them to be males, is when when the males are considered to be fully independent from their mothers and have dispersed from their natal range, then they're adults. When they're hanging around mom in the way that Quarantine and Kunuma did for a couple of months, even after she was no longer feeding them, they're still, in my mind, sub-adults. But it's up for debate. Nobody quite agrees on it. This is a very complicated procedure. Well, there's definitely not much left of the carcass, and I have to say I was hoping for an impala, although I'm glad either way that they got to feed off something. Romay, you wanted to know, would a dacre feed all three leopards with full bellies? No, not really. A Karula will probably be hunting again tonight. If not tonight, then tomorrow morning she'll be out hunting. There's even a good chance that when we come back on the sunset safari, these leopards have moved off. Not far, they probably won't go far. But now, with the cubs, it would have been okay for Karula and the two of them when they were 3 months old, but now they're 7 months old with a voracious appetite. And I've seen Karula eat almost an entire dacre herself before in one sitting. So no, it's definitely not enough to feed all three and make them fat and gorged and full. But it's a jolly good start. It's like a light breakfast. An appetizer. And Karula does have to work exceptionally hard to keep all mouths happy and fed. We are watching as our leopard cub, in a rather macabre way, finishes off what's left of this dacre. And we have a question about whether or not leopards will consume intestines and bladders. And Joseph, you were wondering that and saying, well, would they not be eating fecal matter and urine? It depends. It does depend on the size of the animal that they're feeding off. With large prey like impala, very often they do pull the stomach contents out first. Although we have been in situations, the last kill we saw them on was an impala, and Karula hadn't removed the stomach contents. And I don't know if that wasn't just because she was threatened where she was, so she had to pull it up into the tree quickly. But then I've seen them eat an entire steenbok before, and that, yes, that does include the intestines and the bladder. And I've seen them eat warthogs. Warthog babies start to finish, including the bladder and the intestines. Sorry, I got distracted by the Game Drive channel. So yes, they do. They're not terribly fussy about it. Obviously, the intestinal contents don't have any kind of benefit for them. The nutrient value is next to nothing, and their bodies aren't really equipped for... They're obligate carnivores. They're not equipped for digesting plant material. They're also not adverse to eating rotten meat. Obviously, their digestive systems are much tougher than ours and equipped to deal with things like uric acid, and the stomach contents are of no value, but the actual lining of the stomach and the actual lining of the intestines can have some nutrient value for them, especially the oopsie. Ooh, little one. Isn't his balance incredible? He's 7.5 months old. Think of the acumen equivalent. Sticking a 7.5 month old baby in a tree, it probably wouldn't work out terribly well. But a leopard cub, and just a couple of weeks old, is already climbing trees. And is now, he's perfectly balanced up there. I wonder where the other little trouble is. I'm still desperately seeking. I think she must be... She must be closer towards the drainage. And we're just going to patiently wait our turn. So there we go. a day, less than a day of searching actually, and we finally caught up with the royal family. And we finally have the cubs back on Juma once again. Karula's been keeping them away from us. No, I mean, she's been keeping them south of the boundary. And it is great to see her back. And then we've got the prospect, of course, of at some point, Tundi's going to bring her cubs out of Torchwood, I'm hoping. That's where they are at the moment. And then we'll have a chance to see Karula's grandchildren. See how important a leopard's tail is for balance. You can see how he's stiffened it slightly. It's just providing a very useful counterweight while he tries to feed. And the claw is desperately scrambling for purchase on the branch. I keep saying he. Honestly, I'm not 100% sure, but I think it is him. Been so long since I've seen them that it could actually be Shungile, and she might just be a lot bigger than I remembered her being. It's getting windier and windier. They've managed to find themselves a very good spot in a tambuerti tree, which, as you know, is very toxic to human beings, less so to animals. So it's of no bother to them. And the tambuertis generally prove to be quite a good spot to hide your kill, because one of the biggest threats to a leopard kill that's in a tree, apart from bumbling cubs knocking it out, is the presence of aerial scavengers. And if they spot it, then they'll come and they'll settle down, and if the leopard leaves it for a moment, then they might actually knock it onto the ground. And if they do that, then almost immediately, well, immediately, it runs the risk of being caught up and scavenged by hyenas. And already there's a good chance there's a hyena somewhere around, playing the patience game, keeping an eye on what's happening, and waiting for just that kind of opportunity to shoot forward and grab it. Which is why I keep saying we don't want him to drop the kill. Anna Marie, you were wondering if perhaps the hyenas might be around scavenge parts of the kill. I haven't seen any. But they're usually quite quick off the marks, hyenas. So there's a chance that there's one wandering around. The thing is, at this point, these cubs are so wise to the ways of hyenas. At this age, with their speed and agility and their tree climbing skills, if you think, we probably see one out of every, what would we guess? We maybe see one out of every 20 kills? That might be an accurate reflection. Karula's catching things all the time and feeding the cubs. They would have had lots of encounters with things like hyenas. That's why I wasn't too worried. I mean, it was a little bit of a worry initially, but I wasn't too worried when the wild dogs came into the sighting a couple of weeks ago. It's because I know that these cubs now have the natural instinct and the speed and the reflexes to get out of harm's way as quickly as possible. And for the most part now, there'll be a sort of a wary truce between leopard cubs of this age and hyenas, as long as they don't do anything silly. The biggest risk now to these cubs is if they get overly curious and overly playful and venture a bit too close, get a bit too cocky. I have a feeling that Karula instills sense into her cubs. Can't be easy standing in the tree with the wind blowing like this either, because it's swaying. I started by mentioning that with the young male cubs, they seem to be slightly more aggressive in terms of their turn to feed at the carcass. And Terry, in Oklahoma, you were wondering whether or not there's a pecking order in the leopards when they get to feed. Obviously with lions they fight for access to the carcass, but it doesn't seem to be quite the same with leopards. And generally it's not, no. So once the female will catch something, she'll eat a little bit of it, as much as she wants really, before she decides to go and fetch her cubs. She'll go and fetch her cubs, and then almost invariably she'll let them feed. Sometimes the little cubs growl and snarl at their mother. I've seen it happen before. We saw it with Shadow's cub not too long ago. We've seen it with these little ones as well. Whenever mom tries to go and eat something, they give her a little bit of a lip curl. And I've seen them growl a little bit at each other, but it's not, they don't fight with the same ferocity that lions fight with. But males, naturally in the cat world, have a bit of an advantage. And in terms of hierarchy, let's say we have a situation, let's now include adult male leopards in it. The adult male leopard absolutely takes top spot. We saw it with Tingana. When he stole Karula's kill, he went straight up into the tree. Sometimes they share. If it's a nice big kill, they're not too bothered about it. And we actually saw that with Mbula and Sindila as well. Leopards are curious creatures. They're solitary for the most part. And not terribly bothered by the idea of another leopard's company, but sometimes we do just find them together, and I think it's a product of characters. Mvula's been reported many times sharing kills with Quarantine. Tingana often comes and steals most of Karula's kills, but shares it with the cubs as well. Oh, where are we going? Oopsie. Aha, we're going to see a descent now, and perhaps he'll give away where mom is. Careful! Oopsie daisy! I think this is the little girl. I think I'm wrong, I think it was a little female. This is awesome. Careful girl. She's now reversing down. She's decided that head first is not the way to go, and oh, now we're going sideways. Now we're going head first, now we're going sideways. Oof, and down. And I can't see her at all. Beautifully done. We're going to sit here and wait for our chance to get into a different position. At the moment, obviously, we can't see the leopards at all. While we do that, let's go across to Tayla, who has found one of her favorite animals.
Jamie, indeed, the warthogs are becoming one of my favorite little creatures. So here we've got Mom. Or we actually, you were looking at little one. We've got Mom on the right. And we've got a juvenile little piggy on the left over there, which is quite unusual. They both look quite small though. Even though this female on the right is an adult, she looks quite dwarfed in size. Even her little piglet, who should be almost the same size as her if it's nearly a year old, is looking slightly on the small side as well. So I wonder if these just aren't small little pigs. They didn't get the best genetics, unfortunately. But I love Mom's little mane that she's sort of got going on. Got a nice little comb over. And looks like she's had some highlights as well. You can see that, some blonde highlights. That's the trend at the moment, you know. Louise in FC says it's salon quality. Oh, you got a little bit of a fright there. They're very relaxed with us, actually not too far from our vehicle. We've been so spoilt and have had all the animals up close and personal. Did you see the little one almost fall over trying to get in underneath all those branches? So they're feeding just under all these little sort of dead trees over here, just looking for some grass. And they were doing quite well. They were digging up all sorts of bits of grass that everybody else seemed to have missed. And that's what happens when you are smaller than all the other animals. You can reach in places that are normally quite hard to get. Hello, girl. A lovely girl. And I'm so glad that they're so relaxed with us as well. They do know we're here. I thought they first stopped and they looked at us. They did the warthog freeze and then I thought they were going to bolt away. And then they carried on feeding, which was quite amazing to see. Because as you know, normally you just see the tail end of a warthog and a dust cloud following it. Come on, Mom, go down on your knees for us so we can see that. I love that. I love that when the warthogs go right down and scurry along the ground on their knees. See, they're getting right into all those fallen branches, or broken branches. And I presume that's courtesy of the elephants who have done that. Oh, going to the toilet. Good morning, Elaine. Elaine wants to know, if we think that the animals could stand another year of drought. Now, Elaine, these are obviously just my opinions, of course. It would make for actually a great discussion around breakfast. I don't think they would. It's been a tough year already. So the bush was extremely dry, like it is at the moment in January already. And then we had a little bouts of rain, which brought upon some greenery. And now it is back to sort of like, as Jamie was describing this area earlier, it's like a desert at the moment. So I don't know if they can take too much more of this. I think another year would be pushing it. And I think things like the warthogs and the buffalo and the hippo, they will be suffering, I think, the most. Even I think the impala, you'd start to see looking really miserable and quite bony. So let's not hope that it's going to get to that. And I actually hope that David is correct with his prediction about the rain. I don't care if I don't win the bet. I just want there to be some rain for all the animals. Obviously, it won't be instantaneous with all the grass coming up, but it will take a few days. But I can promise you, quarantine open area will look like a golf course. There'll just be this lush layer of lovely grass filled with animals. And you probably see lots of zebra, lots of impala, lots of warthogs all coming through getting the new shoots. You may even see the nyala and kudu coming through and taking opportunity and eating on the new green shoots, because it will take a few weeks or months for all the trees to get their nice green leaves again. Now you can actually see all the leaves blowing around, and you can also tell how windy it is by the way that warthog's mane is blowing in the air. She's like a model with a fan in front of her face. There, look how she's using her nose. It's got, there we go, down on your knees. Thank you, girl. So she's now down under there, and you can see she's trying to dig up all the grass with her nose. So they particularly go after the roots. Now you can see she's doing that. Doesn't look like she's being too destructive, but warthogs can completely decimate a grassland. So where I'm from, in the Eastern Cape of South Africa, so on the southeast coast, there's a lot of farmland over there, and they like to farm things like pineapples. It's one of the main things. Now, unfortunately, the warthogs will come through and they will actually tear up an entire area, and it's quite devastating what they can do. We might see some of the destruction in the summer months when we get a bit of grass, but they will clear out, because they're not just eating the tops of the grass. They, like for instance, like that what the impala do, they're actually using their snouts, like we saw earlier and like we're still watching. That top ridge is extremely hard, and she will actually try and dig that underneath the grass and lift the grass right out and get to the roots, which unfortunately then kills it. Whereas the rest of the animals, most of them, are just nibbling on the top blades of the grass, not really pulling out the roots. Unless you're an elephant, then the elephants also like to pull the roots out of the ground. So if you have a family of 10 pigs, they could do a lot of damage in one afternoon. Unfortunately, these animals are also still being persecuted because they are known to tear up crops and wreck nice grazing land. Hey, warthogs, don't worry. You are safe here with us. My goodness, it's like she heard me and she thought, persecution, I'm out. But no, never fear. We are not worried about you at all. We are quite happy to have you here. Zach, you've actually asked a great question, and it goes with what we're talking about. So Zach wants to know, do we feed the animals during the drought? And no, as you can see, Look at these warthogs. Look what they're eating. They're almost eating nothing. And if we were feeding them, they'd probably have their faces in a bale of lucerne or something along those lines. So, no, we do not feed any of the animals. It's important that things like drought occur every now and then. We obviously need to get rid of or control populations of the animals. And this is the most natural way to do it. The strongest will only survive. Munch, munch, munch. Like I said, I'm starting to feel hungry and wondering what's for breakfast. Ex-Ranger wants to know, well, she said, and I must say, you've just mentioned something that I didn't even know. So you just told us that animals like dolphins can't tell the difference between whether they're thirsty or hungry. Now, I didn't even know that. I don't know too much, unfortunately, about the marine mammals living in the where we are at the moment. We're quite far from an ocean. And Ex-Ranger wants to know, are there any animals that don't know whether they're thirsty or hungry? And I'm not sure of that. I don't know. How do they test something like that? Like, that's quite bizarre to me, because I don't know how many people can speak the language of the animals and can tell, and how you would even do an experiment like that. So unfortunately, I don't even know how to answer that question. So you have absolutely stumped me. But if you can think of a reason, please let us know if anybody else has any idea. I'd love to hear from you. Otherwise, I'm going to have to try and research that a little bit later. And hopefully that question pops up again and I'll be able to answer it with a response. I've got a lot of researching to do this afternoon, which is great. I love to learn. And I always add things to my trusty notebook, so I need to do some research about those lunar moths, because those are just unbelievable. Like I said, I've only ever heard of them and seen pictures of them, but I've never actually seen one in real life myself. See how those warthogs are now slowly moving off? They're giving us a great show. On their knees again, they found another patch of some dry grass that they could possibly dig out. There we go. So when I was guiding in the Eastern Cape, I was at a lodge down that was based on a river, and one of the rangers came around the corner. I think he'd gone to town to do a bit of shopping, and he came back with not only some goodies from town, but he also picked up a tiny little warthog piglet. And this particular area where this lodge was situated, there weren't any big predators, so there were no lions. We did hear the odd leopard, but the Cape Mountain leopard is quite a scarce creature, so we didn't see too many of them. So he wasn't sure what happened. He had to look around to see if Mom was around, and this warthog was completely decimated. It was so thin you could see her ribs. She was covered in parasites, and it was a freezing cold winter's day. It was rainy. It was miserable. So he actually ended up picking this warthog up, which is something that we don't always do. Well, we ended up naming this little warthog Emma. And I'm actually going to send you on to Jamie, and when you come back to me before we close, I'm going to finish the story about Emma the warthog. But I know I cannot keep you away from Karula and her little cubs.
And the wonderful news is that we have managed to reposition. We've got Karula. We were right, by the way. It was Hosanna up in the tree. There he is now. He's resting next to Mom, giving himself a little bit of a clean. And then young Shungile is up in the tree taking her turn to snack on the daker. There she is. Noticeable size difference. I know it's difficult for us to see, but that is her. Can only be. And it's now her turn to have a little bit of breakfast now that her brother has finished with it. Well done, Karula. And it is just so wonderful to see these cubs again. The joy of Safari Live, I think, is to get to watch little cubs like these grow up and see the changes, if not day by day, then certainly week by week and month by month. And can hear the tree creaking. That's what it was, Dave. We heard a funny sound earlier, and I thought we were at risk of being vomited on by a leopard. It was a funny squeaking sound. And then we realized that it's actually the trees creaking and blowing in the wind. I see them. Okay, we might have to move at some point to give up our good view for yours, who hasn't had a chance to see the sighting. We just enjoy the spot for a moment more, and then I'm going to pull forward a little bit so that he can come and join us. Can't monopolize the best view in the house now, can we? But we waited our turn for it, so we'll enjoy it for a little longer. Kyle, while we look at little Shungile, she is, of course, in line to inherit some of Karula's territory. So what often happens with the females is it's not necessarily that they give up a portion of their territory to their female offspring, but they kind of become neighbors, and yes, the territory shrinks a little bit to accommodate that of her daughters. And Kyle wants to know how big a portion will Shungile get in terms of inheritance, almost. And the answer is it's impossible to answer. Well, there's no way that we can know. It depends very much on the area that she takes. Tundi's got a much bigger, as far as we can tell, she's got a much bigger portion of Karula's old territory than Shadow. And that's just because Shadow's under pressure from other leopards in other directions, and from other sides. So it's impossible for us to say. Karula is, she's not old, but she's getting on in years. And she's reaching at 12 years old. She's probably reaching the end of her reproductive life. In other words, she might have one more set of cubs, possibly. And her territory will start to get smaller as she starts to get older. I mean, she's still in perfect condition. Look at her. Well done, girl. Take your well-deserved rest. You've definitely earned it. After all the effort we saw her putting into yesterday when she was trying to hunt, it's exhausting. She's covered an enormous amount of distance from where she was yesterday. And she does, leopards don't, well, especially not Karula, they don't walk in a straight line. So she probably, in terms of trying to catch this daker, she might have covered 30 kilometers last night. Or yesterday and last night. It's enormous distance. She's definitely earned that nap. Little Hosanna is busy giving himself a thorough wash. He must be feeling quite tired as well. He had to do all that balancing on the top of the tree. Oh, he's up. Let's just see what he's up to. Where are you going to go, little boy? Or are you just cleaning your back foot? You were nearly responsible for planting the carcass on the ground, weren't you? Now, Liz, in Australia, you wanted to know, will leopards, when they're finished with the carcass, leave it in the tree or drop it to the ground? Most of the time, the carcass is dropped to the ground, whether it's by the leopard trying to feed on that last few morsels, or it's by the scavenging action of the bird. But, hello boy. Oh, screenshot opportunity. Beautiful. Beautiful boy. But, that being said, there are still kills left in trees. Leopards don't deliberately dump them. So they are still... Look at him looking up at his sister. He's so gorgeous. There's a dacre kill in a jackalberry not far from here that's been there for months. They don't deliberately remove it. I'm thinking about going and taking more from his sister. I do need to reposition so that we can make space. Sorry, guys. Hold on one moment. So while we reposition, let's head across to Tayla for the last few moments of our sunrise safari.
So our pigs have not gone anywhere, can you believe it? They're being so well behaved. Now I very quickly want to finish my story with you about Emma the warthog, and I will try and find a photo to show you later as well. So anyway, Emma ended up growing up and she lived around the lodge, and I think that all the guests that came through ended up preferring Emma to any of their rangers. She was the star of the show. So what happened with Emma was, though, she obviously grew quite big. She was eating a lot of vegetables and things like that, so I think she was probably eating a little bit more than what she should have, because even at 6 months she was larger than that female we've just been watching now. Now as you can imagine, she became very, very naughty, and we tried to discipline her to the best of our ability, though it's hard to discipline a wild animal. And one of the other rangers, Wayne, always used to keep her in her room, because one afternoon we saw a caracal coming through, actually going straight towards our accommodation where we stay, and we knew straight away this caracal was obviously after this pig. So he decided to start keeping her in a room, and eventually we built a really nice enclosure for her that she could stick in when we were out on safari. So I was telling you quickly, one day I came back and I saw that Wayne's door was open a little bit in his room, and I thought, oh, monkeys. Anyway, and I went to go and close it because he wasn't back. Quickly had a look. Was not monkeys, it was Emma the warthog. And as I walked into his room, I saw Emma on his bed, using the bathroom on his bed. I saw his TV was completely tipped over on the floor, his computer on the floor as well, and every single item of clothing had been pulled out of the cupboards. Well, I didn't know what to do, so I just closed the door, shut it, and went away. It was hysterical, and that was only the start of Emma's and her mischievousness. She was very naughty. So that's one of my little Emma stories, but I hope you've enjoyed the wonderful show today. I just wanted to say a wonderful thank you to all of you. It was amazing experiencing everything that we did today. So cheers for me, and I'll see you this afternoon on the sunset safari. And I know that Eggsy wants to say goodbye too. There we go, little hand. So have a wonderful morning, and I think we'll have one last look at the little warthogs, and then I'm sure you're gonna enjoy saying or having the last few moments of the show spent with Jamie and Karula and her cubs.
Look at this, a beautiful view of Shongile attempting to reposition the Dacre carcass with not much more grace than her brother was earlier. You can definitely see the size difference, though. We are incredibly fortunate to be able to have a scene. I'm really hoping that they are going to be around for the sunset safari this afternoon. I'm going to be keeping my fingers crossed. This, of course, will be the first place that we come to check. Oh, that's very macabre. Whoopsie daisy. Look at the paws gripping the tree. This is so cool. Oh, it's Cataday! I forgot it was Cataday. Anna Marie, you're so happy your main hope for this Cataday was to see Karula and cubs. Well, there we go. They have decided to grace us with their presence, and we are very, very glad that they did. Aren't we lucky? Feels like it's been a long time since we've had a chance to see Karula and her mischievous little ones. And I'm hoping they might decide to stick around even when the Dacre is finished, which it almost is. And I hope that they will be around for the next few days or so. It is time for us to say our goodbyes, unfortunately. I'm actually going to do quick ones, and then I'm going to leave you with the view of the leopards. So a big thank you to all of you. You don't need to, you sort of know what I look like. So a big thank you to Dave for his fantastic camera work as always, as well as to Lou and Rebecca in final control. She's almost there, Dave. There she is, up a bit. As well as to all of you watching across the corners of the globe. We will return here first thing for the sunset safari, so you will have to join us then. For now, going to leave you with a little bit of silence and the view of our beautiful leopards.